We're live.
What's up, guys? Welcome back to the final Back to the Future in Review. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. Kind of Funny is reviewing and ranking every movie in the Back to the Future franchise. I'm Tim Geddes, joined by the beautiful baby boy, Andy Cortez.
They only made three of these guys?
Isn't that a bummer?
This is it. Yeah, Andy, don't worry about it because they made five Transformer movies.
Oh, great.
Technically six with Bumblebee. So, you know, great. Let's go. We got Greg Miller with the hair. I'm loving the swoopy-doo.
Thank you very much. Remember, they did do the Telltale video game. We could review that. It's five episodes, it's 2 hours apiece. Pretty much the same thing.
It's a lot of fun.
So eight more movies. Or like eight in total.
Oh,
like
yeah, five. Eight in total. Yeah.
We got the mad dog, Kevin Koala.
Oh, 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 oh.
Of course, Nick Scarpino.
Oh, hello, everyone. Shit, welcome back.
How you doing, Nick?
Good. Do we think that Kevin wasn't, the audience couldn't hear him when he went, oh, wow, 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 wow. Is that what you're saying? God damn it, too, Kevin?
No. 50-50 chance. Okay. No. Andy zoomed into his camera and ruined my shot.
God damn it. Zoom.
So now that commercial for a car.
That was a commercial. Thank you.
Greg. That didn't deserve that.
Baby, I hear the blues. Like, call in.
Let's fucking go.
We're doing Frasier now?
Jesus. No, we're not. Because this is Tied to Funny in Review each and every week. We review two different movie franchises on Tuesdays and Fridays. You can watch it live on twitch.tv/kindoffunnygames, or you can watch it later on youtube.com/kindoffunny, roosterteeth.com, or you can search your favorite podcast service to listen to it as a podcast. It's fantastic. We'd love giving you options, including getting the show ad-free by going to patreon.com/kindoffunny, just like Mohammed, Justin Toft, Das Bear Jew, and Black Jack did, our beautiful Patreon producers. Today,
thank you for the support.
About,
we love you and your support. Thank you very much. Nick, thank tell you. Him you love him. Daddy,
support
him.
Is so great. It's so great.
Thank you.
Back to the Future, Part 3.
Whoa, Andy just did drugs on camera, guys. That's got to be against the terms of Yesus.
Dude, it's 421, Andy. Wait. Like all right, so here's the deal, guys. You know how movies normally have their little fun working titles?
Yeah.
Any guesses of what the working title for this one was?
Wild Wild West.
Clint just the number three.
Cool.
Yeah. Yeah. Keep it simple.
They were just like, we just need to get this one done. That's what we do. We just need to finish strong and
let's
get
land
this one
fucking
done.
Plane to get our checks.
Released on May 25th, 1990, one day before Kevin Coelho was born.
Whoa.
It's true. Yeah. It's true. One whole day. Yeah.
The harbinger of things
Kevin,
to come.
Kevin, did you go see it right away?
No.
Oh, man.
I waited many years. But then I watched all of them at once, so that was pretty cool, I think. Tim, does that sound right?
Wait, you watched them all at once? You had three different TVs playing the movie simultaneously?
You know what it's I meant? You know what I meant?
Fucking idiot.
It's funny, though. Like, I think,
fun
like,
fact
I think
about that, though, is if you start this movie after the lightning rod is hit on the 1955 clock tower, at the end of the second movie, as Doc then reconnects the wires, it will play seamlessly from the second to the start of this movie.
Wow.
That's cool.
Easter
That's
eggs. Really cool.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What were you going to say, Nick?
I was going to say, like, I just, you know, it's one of those things where I envy future generations for being able to sit down and watch 1, 2, and 3 back to back. Cause I think that would be a really, really, really fun way to spend like 6 hours. Similar to like people who, what's that?
That's what me and Kev did.
Oh, back in the day. That's amazing. Like,
I
want to see them all stitched together in one big.
Sorry, Kevin, I didn't hear that.
It's okay. Greg made fun of me a bunch about it.
Which part I was making a cool statement, but I can double back to making.
Yeah,
one
you want to see them all stitched together? Great, that'd
be cool,
fun,
right? Because
awesome.
They figure
yeah,
all the cliffhangers, you put them all together in one big movie. Now, what am I gonna make fun of you for, Caterpillar Man?
Oh. Why am I Caterpillar?
Because I was thinking about the movies getting stitched together.
Oh, like human caterpillar. I see what you're doing. Human centipede.
Even though caterpillars don't millipede. Do stitching.
But, Andy, what I was thinking is you tape the film together and there'd be colored tape there, much like our favorite caterpillar, that red, yellow, and black one.
May 25th, 1990, when Part 3 came out, 6 months after November 22nd, 1989, when Part 2 came out. Once again, directed by Robert Zemeckis, a budget of $40 million equal to Part 2. A box office of $246.1 million, making it the sixth highest grossing movie of 1990. Nick, can you name the five above it?
Of 1990?
Of 1990.
Shit. No.
Number five.
Maybe like Hunt for October was in there somewhere? Or no. Was that 89?
Number five, Total Recall.
Oh, fuck. Oh. I didn't realize that was a 90s movie.
Cool movie.
Number four, Dances with Wolves.
Great.
Oscar winning movie, right? Yeah. Best picture that year.
Number three, Pretty Woman.
Oh, man, I love that movie. You know?
Number two, Home Alone.
Nice.
That's wild.
And number one, Ghost.
Oh, man. That was a good year for good movies.
Year for movies.
Man. That was a really good year for movies.
Murderers Row. To see it. A runtime of, I didn't put the runtime down. You guys saw the movie.
It was 2 hours and 20, 30, no, 2 hours 30? No, hours.
Look it up. Why are we guessing?
It was 2 hours flat.
While Kevin looks that up, I do want to point out
118
that Greg, in the Discord chat and also in the general of Slack, put a link to the caterpillar he was talking about, because it was so important that we have a visual guide for the black and red furry. It looks like a pipe cleaner.
Now, for the record, this isn't the caterpillar I was thinking of.
So why'd you post this?
I googled storybook caterpillar and he's actually green.
You're talking about the book one, yeah. The one that
he's green.
Yeah. Yeah.
I thought I had a good, clear picture of here and I didn't.
But he still posted this one.
Oh, lordy lord, man.
Also, Barrett asks, who's making the kind of funny thumbnail for Games Daily? Did you do that, Andy?
No, I wasn't asked to.
I'm sure Blessing will do it then. They'll tell Blessing.
Oh, all right. So here's the thing. Before we even get into this, there's one piece of trivia I found that is it's a lot of words, guys. Okay. It's a lot of words, but they're pretty cool words. All right.
Okay. Everybody shut the fuck up. Let Tim talk.
There exists enough clues in all three movies to reconstruct the travels of the DeLorean precisely to within a few minutes at worst, except for 2015's Biff arrival in 1955 and Doc's personal travels. There are a few interesting things to note. Not counting the time Doc traveled by himself, the DeLorean spent nearly 71 years on its own timescale from its first time travel to its destruction. By the time Marty made his ultimate return to 1985, he was approximately 14 days, 3 hours and 27 minutes older than he should have been. Jennifer, on the other hand, is 7 hours and 26 minutes younger than she should have been. Another interesting conclusion is a point of contention. There are two theories, one of which drops the last item. On November 12th, 1955, between the time Biff arrived, or 6 a.m., whichever came later, and 6:38 p.m., the time he left, there were 4 DeLoreans present in Hill Valley from that point of view. The instance when Marty was trapped in 1955 in the original movie, the instance where Biff came to 1955 to give himself the almanac, the instance where Marty and Doc came back to 1955 to take it back, and the instance where it was waiting in the abandoned mine.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
Wow. That's crazy.
Yeah, and there's a lot more fun stuff like that, but like there's a lot of real specific things. I just thought it was the most interesting thing to me was like how long was Marty displaced, because it's crazy to think that this movie continues immediately after the second in the same way the second was immediately after the first. Marty's just going on this fucking
journey, man.
He needs a vacation, man.
But at the same time, it's cool that it's only 2 weeks.
It's crazy, man.
Yeah, in total.
But I also remember at the end of this, he probably does end up going up to the lake with Jennifer and banging it out. So, good on him.
Good on him.
He makes
good
Martina McBride right there.
Oof. Marlene. Her name was Marlene.
What did we think about this movie, boys?
It's really enjoyable.
Yeah, I'm always, when you think about the Back to the Future trilogy, everyone always kind of has. Everyone thinks about 2 as being like the one that sticks out, but then you watch them back to back and I'm always blown away by how entertaining 3 is.
Yeah.
It's a Western. I don't really care about the Western genre as a genre, but I think they do enough with it and they bring enough of the science in to make it really, really fun. And I think my favorite part of this movie is where he has that big machine. And when I first saw it, I was like, what's that for? And then he goes, what's that knob? And he twists it. And then one just shitty ice cube comes out and the whole thing is just like to make an ice cube. It's like a refrigerator. It's just things like that where I'm like, you do get to play around with the idea of like how much knowledge you would have if you went back, like if you were a scientist who went back to that time period and were able to invent all these cool things that could change the landscape of like American history. So I think that's the fun part of this one. And I think it's just it's a much tighter film than 2. And it brings in, again, shout out to I really got to remember this guy's name, the guy that plays Biff or Mad Dog in this. Thomas F. Wilson, just bringing a completely different character to Mad Dog. that you just is totally different than Griff, totally different than Biff. He's so good in this.
So he plays Buford Mad Dog Tannen in this, performed all of his horse riding stunts himself. He also did the trick where he lassos Marty just before you meet the 1885 Doc.
Was that actually Marty?
Michael J. Fox ain't doing that shit, no.
Yeah,
probably.
He ain't getting drugs.
There were close-ups on him as he was being dragged around at like 1 mile an hour.
Talking about the lasso part, not the drag part.
Got it.
Yeah, I've obviously seen these movies a ton, but I can't remember. I don't think I've ever sat down with a critical eye right after Back to the Future 2 and been like, let's watch this and see what we think of this kind of thing. And I think this is a better movie than Back to the Future 2. And that's crazy. Coming into I never would have said that. But I think, we talked about Back to the Future 2.
Yesterday you told me that, like, I was going to be shocked by what your opinion was.
Yeah.
And even knowing that, I was still shocked.
He's shocked.
I gasped when you said that.
I mean, I know we'll do it more when we get to the actual rankings of it, but I think we talked so much about last week's Back to the Future 2 having a rough start to it and not really grabbing us in the front. But then once we get back to 55, you see this like really, this storyline come together and there's a whole bunch of cool shit with time travel and yada, yada, yada. I never felt like this one was struggling, and that's not the right word, but I never thought like I was waiting for it to get going. I thought we dropped in, had a whole bunch of exposition, and then we were ready to go and we were having a good time and we were out there. And even the things I think in my head that I had remembered being more corny weren't as corny as I thought they were. You know what I mean? I know where, I think for some, I don't understand how, but like I think the effects look better here where they're doing more of the split screen, Michael J. Fox playing two different characters, you know what I mean? Like having them all share the same space and have it actually. Yeah. Be cooler and not as like vibrating walls as Back to the Future 2. But I had a great time and I really, really enjoyed this movie.
I had a great time with it. I thought it was much better than I remembered giving this movie credit for. I do feel like overall though, it feels lesser than 2. Like, and I think that a lot of that has to do with just the Western side of it. It is way more.
Do you think that's because you're not interested in Westerns?
Or
do you
it's definitely because I'm not interested in Westerns, like 100%. I don't like that aesthetic at all. Yeah. But in addition to that, I just think that, they told a very straightforward story here, which I think is good because it actually all added up and made sense. And like they landed the plane. You said that earlier. But like that really is what I want to give credit to this movie for. But I still just think that they didn't take any risks, really. So it's like, all right, well, you did the thing, but it's not like that impressive. I'm interested to see what Andy has to say because this is your first time ever watching this.
Yeah, I had a great time with it. I think it was notably less gimmicky than part two because they didn't really have to show off, hey, here's what we do in the Western times. Like there's some moments with the ice cube, but I feel like part two, the first hour of it was only that. With this, I found myself just a lot more interested and intrigued with Doc Brown's like love life. Like I cared about him. I cared about his personal issues where, in the first two movies, he's the scientist guy that you just sort of follow along and
it's Marty's story, right?
Yeah, it's Marty's story, but I love sort of getting that deep dive into his life and seeing what he cares about and what he actually wants. And I love that it wasn't I love that even though there are multiple Martys and Docs that we're talking about or referencing, we always kind of know. They do a great job of letting it's not confusing. And I appreciate that where we know, oh, this is 85 Doc here right now. Like I think it's all pretty straightforward and the story was great. I had a really good time with it, man.
That's one of the things I really like about this one too is that it actually gets to be Doc and Marty, the real Doc and Marty, not confused 1955 Doc and Marty kind of hanging out, and you get to see their relationship sort of kind of come not to an end but to a fitting conclusion. And it's the same with Marty's story, right, where we spent largely two was just kind of thrown together so that they could get another character arc for Marty, and this one really is the end of that, which is cool. So I think that like whereas two suffered because it sort of had to build upon the shit left over from one, I think three moves forward and succeeds because they Bob Gale and Robert Zemeckis were able to like put enough build up and enough setup so that when we get to three, they can have that nice lean, no fat script where every single beat is there for a reason. And I'm always blown away when they like every time they get to that point where they talk about Clayton Ravine, and I'm like, oh God, they thought ahead, right? They have to take her out of the timeline. So how do they do that? Well, she died there. She was supposed to die there. And in saving her, Doc actually gets to take her with her. He needs to take her out of the timeline because he's already altered the future. So in doing the right thing, he actually does the right thing. What's that?
There is one mistake where it's like if Doc died and his tombstone had Clara's name on there, that means in that timeline, he did already save Clara, which means that Marty, should have been changed and not known that it was Clara Ravine or the whatever it was called.
Clayton Ravine, yeah.
Clayton Ravine. He should have been like, no, it's that's the right name, the Shauna or whatever it was. And Doc should have been like,
heavy. Well, no, doesn't that, and I'm, this is just fun, nerdy stuff, unless you know something I don't know. Wouldn't that not track because Marty is out of time himself? If he was in 1985, not time traveling, then the timeline should have caught up to him. But him being from another alternate reality, similar to when they did the Biff stuff, right? It wouldn't have changed for him because he's out of place as well.
I think we're
splitting hairs about fictional time.
Yeah, I think the bigger issue for me is that this is the first time that I realized that apparently Andy's family, much like the original British royals, are just completely inbred. Why would Leah Thompson look? Why would she look?
That
Marty
is also
like
another
mom?
Really creepy.
Do they just only let them fuck each other over and over?
It's that was very really, weird. Really weird.
I love her in this. I love they did that, but it would be weird to go back and see a person that looks exactly like you as your great great grandfather and a person that looks exactly like your mom. I'd be like, what's going on with this?
So
what's
if,
happening?
If I'm thinking about this correctly, because the tombstone said Clara and the DeLorean was there, like that is the future of that past, right?
It should be.
He should, like, if the DeLorean's there, then Marty should have grown up knowing the name of that ravine in its original form, not the.
But again,
not the first timeline, right?
It would, the timeline split when Doc saves Claire, and now they're traveling and caught up in this timeline that they're not from.
Right.
By
like,
your
the original timeline is Doc was never there. It. No one was ever there to pick her up. She went into the ravine. So
the
as Marty grew up, he always knew it as Clayton Ravine.
That makes sense. For you, Kevin, like, right, and for your argument, which I get, don't get me wrong, I think the writing to back that up would have been in the movie of when Marty's holding, in Back to the Future 1, holding the picture of his brother and his sister and his brother's heads. He would have had to been like, I don't even remember what he looks like. I can't remember what he looks like.
Right. You're making a lot of sense. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, they tried to reach out to Crispin Glover to play Seamus, but fuck y'all.
Was this already solved? Do you know when their lawsuit was actually solved and they got?
I'm sure it wasn't solved yet because you have to remember the movies came out 6 months apart from each other.
So this
right?
must have been in the beginning when they were trying to get him, and he wanted $1 million. Right?
He should have been like, "I'll do it, but I'll do it for like $3 million and drop the lawsuit." Because he's got a terrible fucking agent. I don't know who his agent is, but like they fucked him.
Well, he's crazy.
I think it's got to be that like this is all the same thing, right? Since it was 6 months apart and it was all filmed at once, this is still the same litigation that gets him. Because they, I feel like the George McFly lookalike at the end gets even more screen time.
Yeah, if it were me, I'd be like, how about you put me in the third one as a prominent role, pay me a dickload of money, and I won't sue you, and give me residuals for the other one as well. That's what I would have, that's the deal that I would have pulled. Because Crispin Glover did Charlie's Angels after this, and that was pretty much it.
Hot Tub Time Machine.
He did Willow, right?
He did do Hot Tub Time Machine, that's right.
Every moment in this movie where we get those callbacks that we sort of we could see coming a mile away, they're still so rewarding. Like I never once got to one of those callbacks with the manure falling or any one of the him calling him chicken, but him calling him
yellow belly.
Yeah, like all those moments, I think are so cool and still so well done that I appreciated them more here than I did in part two for some reason.
But I feel like it's because they were introduced in two to be paid off in three, and that's why I think that watching three makes two better. Dark World and Endgame, where it's like
the manure moment as well. That was part one, like that. Yeah.
But I feel like there was a lot of things in part two that felt random that get payoffs.
That was our thing last week when we were talking about it without spoiling stuff was it's going to be interesting. This one suffers because it is trying to set up three in a very direct, like they introduce, Mad
Dog. That doesn't mean that two's better because of that in retrospect.
No.
Going back and watching two is still boring, hour and a half of it.
Whoa.
Like, I feel like this movie just is super. It brings back that fun, and then it also tops it off with you watch this and you have a weird nostalgia for the first movie, even though it's the third in the series, because this is that sort of like, hey, we're wrapping everything up and we're gonna stick the landing. And I think somehow, even though we've seen this gimmick already two times before in the other movies, the idea of having to get the damn thing up to 88 miles per hour under steam engine ends up being this super fun. This like moment
thrilling
that I feel like lasts just enough. And then of course they have that setup of the big issue we had last week, or not big issue, but one of the weird things we had last week was like, why are you so fucking up on Marty about this almanac, but you let him take a fucking hoverboard back with him into 1985, of course, has the payoff here where they get to ride off literally into the horizon and live with each other. It's nice because it's like, it is that nice fitting send off to Doc. And then Marty just gets to live the rest of his life and probably be a little bit bored shitless with whatever happens to him, because he's gone on and had this unbelievable adventure.
Nothing will compare.
Nothing will ever compare to this.
Hey man, he just wants some downtime. You know what I mean? He wants to not have his mom trying to.
He just wants to bang that wig off of Elizabeth's shoe.
Jesus Christ!
Something I do want to point out: I had never noticed in all my viewings of Back to the Future 3 until this time a great understated acting moment from Michael J. Fox when he gets out of bed at the McFly Ranch
and looks at his pants.
He pulls it out and before he gets out of bed, he checks if he has pants on.
Yeah.
And then he gets up and walks away. And it's like, damn.
That's great. I didn't know.
Totally. I didn't know that. That's really funny.
I've always tracked Taya Leone, or not Taya Leone. God, why do I always do Leah Thompson? Love Taya Leone, though.
The first scene in this movie where Marty goes back to the future in the time machine powered by the bolt of lightning striking the clock tower appears in all three films.
Hell yeah, cool. It does.
Interesting.
Pretty fucking cool. Let's get into the beginning of this movie, guys.
The year is 1985, ladies and gentlemen. We pick up basically exactly like how 2 picked up from the end of 1, 3 picks up from the end of 2, right? The DeLorean's going back in time to send Marty back to 1985. It does. Congratulations. Yay, everybody. As Doc celebrates in the streets of Hill Valley, Marty rounds the corner, runs up to him. Doc faints once again, right? I just came back from the future. Then we get Marty, he's taking Doc to the Brown Estate, which is still good and big and all that shit. You know what I mean? Good and big, Nick. That's what you like, isn't
good
it?
And big. Sick fuck, it's better than thin and like thin. It's not pleasing
thin
anyone.
Thin. Nobody wants that, Andy. You know what I'm saying, Andy? Go over there and kiss that peep. We get in there and yeah, everybody's just having a chill moment sleeping. Everything's drying in front of the fireplace. The letter that should, of course, completely fucking destroyed. And just
this scene lasted way too long.
Right.
Like when 100%. We first saw clouds in this, I was like, oh, we're going to get another fucking cloud sequence. And instead, no, we just get this weird ass look around his house that isn't interesting.
You hang out outside of the house a long time too. Like long enough where you're like, why the fuck am I still outside this house? Let me inside the house already.
Didn't like this.
No, but you get in, you get a pan around the house, it goes too long, right? And then it's just going to be exposition. And Doc wakes up, he immediately goes to his recorder. He doesn't see Marty or the fucking hoverboard or anything. He's talking about how he can't remember how he got home. Marty walks up to him. Doc freaks out. It's a callback to, you know, number one. He calls him Future Boy again. And there's this ongoing conversation here about this and like, how would you do all this? And how do you know if there's one problem with your plan, Future Boy, if you're from the future, how do you know all this stuff about, you know, 1885 or whatever? And he's like,
the cool thing here is when Doc freaks out and runs to the bathroom, there's the clock above the toilet.
Nice.
Which is the story he dealt. Like, that's how he finds the flux capacitor. Right.
He also still has the scar on his head from the fire when he cracked it open.
And that's the one thing, too, I'll put out here. I think, for me, in the movie, the movies, watching it when it's Michael J. Fox from number one and Michael J. Fox from 2 and 3, it's always obvious which Michael J. Fox I'm looking at, I feel like. Christopher Lloyd, like, he is so good at looking like Back to the Future 1 Emmett Brown. Even when they're using, because they show, like you said, Tim, the original footage of him, you know, sliding down, connecting the things. Marty goes back in time. He celebrates. And then it cuts to the way I know it being different, obviously, because Marty runs into frame. But the fire looks faker because they had to keep it going longer or whatever. So it's like, but Christopher Lloyd himself looks so fucking good and so much like original Back to the Future 1 Doc.
But I think so good to the point that I think that he is confusing as to which Doc he is in time.
You don't think the story gives it away?
I mean, the story gives it away, but visually, I feel like Doc always kind of just looks the same in a way that Marty.
Because that wig is so distinctive. And like Marty, you know, no matter what you do, Marty's aging a little bit. But they were able to remember also, like, the first time we see Doc in 1985, he's got that terrible makeup on. So your first introduction to him is that he's this older guy. So, of course, every time as the years passed, from the, you know, the 4 years when they started making these movies, he just looks kind of
more and more.
Whereas as Michael J. Fox goes from being like, you know, and those are the formative years too. Michael J. Fox goes from being like 23 years old to a fucking 37-year-old man overnight. And they just put him in the same jeans, like just shoehorn his ass into that. Just
fucking go. Anyways, they break out the letter and they start reading the letter. And again, Doc has left an extensive letter explaining that he is, of course, in 1885, that he has been working as a blacksmith. Everything's good. He's hidden the DeLorean in the old mines. You can go get it there. He's left a giant schematic here. So 1985 or 1955 Doc can build the time chip that's been fucked up, you know, with a current 1955 parts. Everything's gonna be fine. Under no circumstances should you come back to get me, Marty. Leave me be. I'm fine here. I don't mind. I like the old West. And Marty and Doc are like, cool, fuck old Doc. We don't care. And Doc, you know, 1955 Doc's like, it's cool, man. I love the old West. That's got to be fun to be back there fucking worrying about diphtheria and polio and all this shit. You know what I mean?
But he talks about how it's like his retirement, right? He's like, there's nothing better I can imagine than retiring in the Wild Wild West with all the clean air and the open landscape and all that stuff. And apparently the bears that just come out of nowhere.
All right. We all know bears live in caves.
It's true. Right? They're den animals.
They eat honey.
They do. God, they love it. They don't wear pants. Just shirts. They don't wear pants.
Just like Tim. Tim.
Picnic baskets.
Yeah, they love a good picnic basket wearing a tie. Oh my God. All right. So anyways, then as I go to the mines, we'll get this thing. So they go to, they might have to blast. And so the next shot is them blasting and they blow it up and they start walking through the mine. 1955 Doc's like, this is really cool. It reminds me of one of my favorite novels, Journey to the Center of the Earth by Jules Verne. This is neat and cool and blah, blah, blah. And they're just talking about that. And Marty's eventually like, hey, Doc, look at this. And then he turns around and it's ELB. Emmett's initials written on this one plank, and he's like, just like in Journey to the Center of the Earth. So they blow they knock that out in a perfect hole that does just is too perfect. And they look in, and then sure as shit, there it is, the old DeLorean wrapped up, put on some what do you call that, Kevin? Boxes? I don't even know. It's elbow cards.
You nailed it.
Like boxes.
You call them boxes, Kevin? Is that what they are? I don't know if you know this. In the future, we don't use boxes.
It gave me goosebumps. You know, seeing this.
Yeah. It's cool. It's
very cool. The musical little flair.
It was also really cool. So well wrapped up. Like the tires were wrapped, and the detail is interesting.
Yeah, but
it's like, I don't know if the tires would last that long.
No, they didn't, because if you look at the tires, the actual rubber has disintegrated from the rim.
Yeah,
and he switches them out for the white.
That's why he switches them out for those white walls, which I thought was a really cool choice, because someone had to sit there and go, how would this piece of metal and all this machinery age? Now, granted, after 70 years, all the bushings, any rubber piece on that thing would be gone.
Yeah.
So you'd have to really do some retrofitting on it. And I think a lot of the electrical systems probably might have gotten eaten through by rats and shit. But it's cool that they at least threw a nod to that of like,
totally.
It's old. Yeah, let's make sure this thing looks like it aged and sat in a cave for 70 years. Although there wouldn't be any rust on it probably, because the cave wouldn't have that much moisture in it.
They go in there and they start looking stuff, and like, this is where he does the whole thing of like, as you can see, the lightning strike fried the time chip or whatever, and it's Doc looking, and he's like, no wonder it broke. Made in Japan. Doc, all the best stuff comes from Japan. And so they wheel it out there, like Nick says. You see that the wheels are done. They load it up with the truck, and then it's all right, it's time to head back or whatever. Copernicus, though, the dog won't come, and that dog won't hunt, and he's over there crying. And Marty's like, I'll get him. And Marty walks over there to get him, and he's over there mourning on Emmett Brown's gravestone. Oh my
god! Smart dog.
Yeah.
Huh? Oh, smart. Well, you know, dogs are like that. You know what I mean? It's all the time. If I throw a sock outside right now and I let Portillo loose, he'd find it. You know what I mean? That's how it is.
I highly doubt that.
You stay tuned to my Instagram live today. I'll see what happens.
Break his hip on the way down.
I'm not throwing him out the window. Anyways, Marty freaks out. Doc comes over. He freaks out. They take a photo of it. You know, it's a week after the Monday after he, or it's a week after he sends.
Yeah,
the
a week
letter.
After he sent it.
Yeah, exactly. And on a shot in the back over a matter of $80 by Buford Mad Dog Tannen, and mourned by his beloved Clara. And he's like, what Clara? I don't know. I don't know any Clara. Of course, you don't know Doc, but whatever. And they look at the thing and it's, you know, whatever. And they're like, well, what the fuck is going on, man? We got to try to figure this out. And maybe it's a different Emmett Brown. Of course, it was the right Emmett Brown. They go to the Hill Valley library/archives. They're looking through old historical records and documents and newspaper clippings. They're struggling to find anything related to Emmett Brown. He seems to be a ghost. He seems to have nothing on there. But they find Buford Mad Dog Tannen's photo, by the way. Lo and behold, they do discover a photo of the clock tower installation, basically the clock before it got put up there. And it's Doc Brown out there posing with it. Oh, my God. It is him. You know what I mean? Yeah.
It's just so – it's like – it's one of those things we always bitch about. Like, how coincidental. It's always Tatooine. I love this fucking clock tower just being the through line of all of this.
Yeah. Cool. Yeah, yeah. It's just great. Yeah, they did a great job here making that be the thing, right? So a plan is hatched basically to send Marty back to save Doc, to stop this from happening, bring Doc back to 1985, set the timeline right. He doesn't know he's about to die. And even still, I'd be like, well, you know what? He died. That's what he wanted. But he doesn't want to die apparently. Whatever. We'll fucking save him.
That does seem a little flimsy and weird. Where it's like, sure he dies, but like
Doc's like, I don't want to die.
Yeah.
It's like, a week after, you know, that he sent the letter. Yeah. He's been there for what, like 2 months or something?
Six, I think.
Was it six?
But yeah, it's still like Okay, but like, where do we draw the line? Where do we draw the line?
At this point, the line has been thrown out. I'm going to go back in time
to save another guy's life, essentially.
It's like, funny.
Where do we put it? Where do we cut it off, right?
It's funny that, like, future Doc that's in the past right now will, like, be like, hey, no, Marty, I can't tell you about this accident that happens. It's like, the rules are out of the door. Just tell him about the accident.
Yeah, I know, totally. But we digress, of course. They fix up the time machine. They put this cool, the new time chip, which is, like, you know, super tiny.
It's a microprocessor, right?
Exactly, is a gigantic board on the hood of the DeLorean. I love it very much.
Strapped like, there with, like, leather straps.
Yeah. So they talked about the giant white walls on the DeLorean. It fucking looks cool. They go to the drive-in theater, because I guess that's just the place with enough not only is it enough runway for 88 miles per hour, as Marty calls him out, like, this is a fucking trek back to Hill Valley. He's like, well, you need to be out in the middle of nowhere. This will all be open. You can hide the DeLorean here. You can't risk somebody seeing you. Like, okay, I guess that kind of tracks. That makes sense. But also, it's like, I got you some clothes. He comes out. He looks like a fucking clown, Nick. You know what I mean?
Yeah, he looks like a car. He looks like a kids TV show cowboy.
Howdy fucking doody.
Did you like the little atoms that were embroidered on the side there?
Yeah, that's cool. I never saw Clint Eastwood dress like this, Doc. And he's like, fucking get in the car, you bitch kid. we gotta go back and save myself. All right, fine, whatever. I'll get in the fucking car.
Jesus.
So Marty gets in the car. And then in just like when you can see them in the writer's room and they're like, all right. So we're sending Marty back to the future, and Doc's helping him, Well, what's Doc going to do while he sends him back to the future? And the one guy in the writer's room is like, sit there? And he's like, no, Doc's got to do more than that. So give him a stopwatch and a gun to fire in the air. And they're like, why? Is there like a lightning? No, there's nothing he has to time out with at all. Doc's just a crazy person. Everybody's like, all right, cool.
Say ready, set, go.
I guess, guys, I could totally 100%. Too hard for Marty to
take his fucking fat foot and shove it on the gas pedal, I guess.
I could see him doing that, though. Like, that makes it like, if I'm sitting there, I'm sending this kid back to the past.
Back.
Because it's the first time we've gone that far.
Totally.
Back.
No, you're right. You're right.
I'm going to be like, all right, let's make sure everything goes off correctly. It's like, well, no one needs the time. This is like, well, this is for science. Why do you have the gun? Like, this is for science. Go.
Like, all right, cool. Yeah.
Also, like, maybe give me the gun because I might encounter a bear or something back then. Like, send me back armed, for Christ's sake. Every time they go, they know they're going to encounter a Tanner that's going to try to fucking kill them. So, like, just give me a fucking Uzi. Let me just spray and pray. Who cares?
And that was, and I would like to see Doc give him some money, some gold or something.
Arm me with something. But like, by the way, we have however much time we need to prepare for this plan, right? It's not like we have to immediately do this the next day. We could wait a year. I could hang out in 1955, bang my mom again or whatever the fuck he wanted to do, check back in with my dad, and then buy like appropriate clothing,
hang out,
and then go back into the past.
But again, remember, Marty's youth is waning by the second.
It's been 14 days. He's fine.
He's 37-year-old man. Wait, hold on, guys. What happens to this Doc?
This Doc just continues forward.
To become our 1985 Doc who wears a bulletproof vest and doesn't get shot.
Yeah.
Right.
But so he just lives in 1985. So when Marty comes back, there's just him and Doc still get to hang out?
Mm-hmm.
No, because at end of this, Doc goes off.
Is now the Doc in the time train.
Yeah.
Which Doc is that, though?
That's the 85 Doc that wore the bulletproof vest.
Yeah.
Keep in mind, and I know, just stick with me for one second. Keep in mind, Tim, that this is not Avengers time travel. This is Back to the Future time travel. So when you catch up to the present, there's only one Doc in where it should be, right? And that didn't even make it any clearer, I understand. But remember that like we're dealing with the Doc of 1985, who at the end of Back to the Future 1 was like, I'm going to go to the future. Then he came back from the future. It's like, I need you. Then he went back. Then he got sent to the Old West. Then he came, well, theoretically, where nobody knows where he fucking goes. But he builds a time travel and train with Clara and stuff.
And then Doc's travel through time.
The knowledge of other Docs as we catch back up to the timeline.
Yeah.
While you continue the plot here, Greg, I'm going to need you to draw me out. Money? I'm going to need you to draw me out a sort of diagram.
Of what?
Of just all the time travel stuff.
Okay.
Thank cool. you.
We'll just.
I don't know.
Sit in silence. It all tracks because remember, after he wore the bulletproof vest, right? He wakes up. He's like, Marty, it's all good. And then Marty returns home, and then Doc takes he goes into the future and then comes back and picks him up. So
the Doc in the beginning of this movie?
The Doc in the beginning of this movie continues on and then eventually reads the original letter that Marty wrote him saying, hey, the Libyans are going to shoot you, wear some, like, prepare for that.
That had already happened.
Wow, Greg did it pretty quickly.
That was really fast. Thank
you. Oh, look at what Kevin brought up too. Both of y'all are doing
that's,
it.
That's it's actually surprisingly close to what this one is, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
Ah, it's really good, Greg.
I'm it's not that hard to follow, you know. I mean, Tim's no.
Wait, hold on.
Make it more complicated.
No, I'm not. It doesn't add up.
You're thinking of it with a event.
In fourth dimension,
we're fucking.
I'm just got a real problem with that.
Tim,
I just you guys still aren't giving me an answer about this doc.
The doc
that just shot the gun.
The doc just shot the gun. He went back to his house and kept developing the time machine until 1985, yeah, where he became friends with Marty and started the whole thing over.
Yeah.
So he is the one that goes, but then he doesn't get shot and keeps going.
Right.
Fair. Got it.
Lives his life.
I was thinking it was 1985. You're right. That totally makes
1955.
Sense.
1955. Greg, yes, said 1985 at the beginning, but it's
gotcha.
Not.
Gotcha. Yep. Yeah. Totally adds up.
Tim, it wasn't another way of
thinking
fault
about it. Remember that, like, Doc in 1955 to 1985, and then meeting Marty in the 80s and becoming friends with him is very much like the young Parrish boy from Jumanji. Remember, they went back to the past, and they come up, and then they have the end of the movie where they're like, "Oh my God, they're here!" And they
get to see a movie.
Doc would have had that as well.
What a franchise.
Right? What a franchise. Let's do that.
Nice indeed. Anyways, right before they go, by the way, Marty's like, and those Indians won't be there. And Doc's like, no, there won't be Indians there. They're just a fucking pain in you, well, idiot. Also,
that's the dumbest thing that Marty could have said. You know what I mean? Like, it's one of those things where it's like, Marty, that's a fuck. Clearly.
If you time travel,
why would there? Yeah, you know how this works.
But Kevin, no, real quick, he's only been in this for like 2 days. He doesn't understand
it's
how
been
all
a
this
week
stuff works.
We know no, that that's it's not, been a week, I mean, he's only traveled back like twice. Four times.
Yeah, but I mean, think about how long it would take you to become an expert at it. At least five times.
But it's not. Anyways, what he should have done is I'm going to go into the future, get the conversion done again to this car so that it can fly. Then I'm going to go into the past. Then I can land wherever the hell I want and not get attacked by people. Pick up the dock, come back, boom, everything's fixed. Instead,
again,
he's
there doesn't
I'm gonna
need
drive where there's no fucking roads.
Yeah, again, you're absolutely right. There does not need to be any sense of urgency. Marty could, again, spend 2 years preparing for this, go back, and we have a time machine. And by the way, why do they always go back 5 fucking minutes before the bad thing happens?
No,
go back a month and pick him up. They're like, hey, man, I came back a month. So we have a month to deal
so
with
So they
this.
Did 5 days
for the
sake this time.
Of argument. Just for the sake of argument, everybody, and I know we're just this is
go back the day he arrived.
Couldn't
so
he just tell 1985 Doc everything, or 1955 Doc in the letter everything? Similar to also check your pocket for the you're gonna get shot. And so he wears the bulletproof vest, and then when he gets to where he should be flying above the billboard, he lands the fucking car.
Greg,
that's a possibility as well. I mean, I don't know if that
it's
would
a
necessarily 30-year
and like 2 days like time span. Like, yeah,
isn't it also worth pointing out that I guess too, where we're with 1955 Doc, they just have a conversation about not building a time machine ever. Like, hey, yeah, you figured out it works. Hey, and
well, no, but then at that point,
nothing good comes from it. Really, you won't let us use it to get fucking rich.
I think they want Marty's family to still be well off. Like, I think they want all that stuff to still happen the way it is because he's seen the future now. He doesn't want
that
to change
is fair.
Any of
that is fair. That
he just wants to save Doc.
Time out.
They've already made the changes.
Yeah, exactly. 1955.
But that means it's already
been
built. You know what I mean?
Right. But if he tells Doc, hey, don't do this. Don't do this at all, and you'll save your life. They'll never be friends. Nothing will ever happen, and then it'll revert back.
Friends? You can just have the amp and the fucking guitar.
No. So that would then create a divergent timeline that they would all be living in, where it's like, sure, now he doesn't build the time machine, but the time machine already exists because the rules of this time traveling universe.
Has to happen once it happens, kind of thing. Yeah.
Right. Well, I mean, it's already happened.
I digress. He starts up the fucking car. He drives towards the wall, 88 miles per hour. Doc shoots the gun a bunch of times.
I think this is arguably one of the most fun and coolest cuts of this. You see him whip through, and then all of a sudden, the Indians that were painted, or the Native Americans that were painted on this thing, become
real.
Playing
with the movies.
Yeah, no. But they come through, and obviously, he starts riding toward them, riding horses. Yeah. And he's like, holy shit.
And then on top of that, it's like, so we're so used to the Back to the Future score being iconic and awesome. They introduced this whole new theme for Back to the Future 3 here, and it is equally rad.
The Western.
I love this shit, man. Like, this is what Hollywood movies at their best.
I was going to say that's another reason, by the way, why these movies, I feel, are cohesive, because they got Alan Silvestri back and they got Dean Cundey back. I mean, not back. I mean, literally, they were all working on these as they were shooting them back to back, right? And I think that's it's such a cool treat when the filmmakers can do that. And it's very rare that you can get the full team of like your upper level production heads to actually come back and redo the movie, because then it always feels good. I hate when they change the theme of a movie, like a sequel, and then they get a different person to shoot it, and everyone's already aged, and it just feels
the
like,
Iron Man franchise.
Yeah, it just doesn't
three
feel
different theme songs.
Right. Yeah, exactly.
Thunderstruck. So he drives on through it. Indians are there. He yells Indians. Again, Native Americans, but we're playing fast and loose with the thing. Because I don't know if you look around that 1955 drive-in, there is a lot of cultural appropriation. That's not he, you know, basically U-turns it, drives away from the Indians. He just fucking is flooring it. These Indians are coming up fast. He takes it off the little ledge, drops down, and then he looks behind him, and he's like, oh, there's a cave. Slams it in reverse, shoves it in the caves. Native Americans come riding over the thing. They jump down. They're like, did we just see a fucking thing from the future, aliens, and did it not affect us at all? You're 100% right. Let's keep going.
But here's the thing. It also just popped in out of nowhere. Like, they were all running, and all of a sudden it appears and disappears. And they're getting chased by these cavalry.
Exactly, by the cavalry. And it's one of those things where, like...
You're like, oh, that's a weird thing. Why would they do that? And sure as shit, yeah, Marty goes up over the top, and guess what? It's the cavalry. And he screams, it's the cavalry! And then he jumps down, and the cavalry's like, did I just see a guy in a pink shirt? Don't have time to worry about this at all. And that makes more sense. And they jump over, and they ride down, and they're chasing down after these Native Americans.
They were trying to kill some Native Americans.
Yeah, they saw a white guy. They were like, he's clearly fine. Let's go.
Good enough by us. He passes.
And then he has a black sheep moment where he just rolls down that hill. I wish it would have lasted longer.
We're not there yet.
Yeah, we're not quite there yet.
So, yeah, Marty then goes back in to retrieve his boots, the photos, and everything else. He puts the photos or the photo in his pocket. He put something else in there, too. I forget what it was. Puts the photo in his pocket. Grabs his boots, and then he looks over, and guess what? Battery There's an arrow in the time machine. He pulls that out. He might have done this already. And then he's like, that's weird. And then he smells gas, and he looks down, and the gas is pouring out. And he's like, oh, no big deal, just gas. And then before he can put anything under it to catch the gas, because I think he would have. Bear roars. He's like, oh, my God, it's a bear. And he runs out, and this black bear chases him. And then the black bear is giving him a good run.
It's the best bear.
Tosses his boots at them, and he stops to eat the boots. And so Marty's now free and clear, you'd think, right, in his moccasins, Nike shoes. But instead, yeah, he rolls down a hill and tumbles down in his thing and tumbles like
black sheep. God, so violent. The whole thing.
Forever and ever and ever.
The head just smashing through the fucking wood.
At this point, Marty's had three concussions.
Right, nobody's going to believe a goddamn word this kid says.
Yeah, he's going to be fucking losing time when he gets back to 1985.
You know 100%. I mean. Yeah, he's going to have anger issues and not know how to deal with them. Yeah, exactly. Smashes through the fence and then passes out, and one Seamus McFly comes and finds him. We then get the classic Back to the Future scene of Marty waking up in bed, disoriented after getting a concussion. And he's like, what's going on? Blah, blah, blah. And Maggie McFly is there talking with an Irish accent and reveals that, of course, he's on the McFly farm. McFly farm! And he sits up, and we get another callback to everything that's happening here, right? Oh, I should have pointed out, when we were going through the Hill Valley archives, we saw a photo of the McFly family, including a grown William who was his great-grandfather. That's right?
What, mm-hmm. Yeah, and was that... it was his great-grandfather. But was that the dude that played his dad, right?
These are all Marty. These are all Michael J. Fox.
Oh, was that also Michael J. Fox?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. Yeah.
It was a clean shave of Michael J. Fox with his hair kind of slicked back and around. So you think you're going to see him, but instead you get Seamus with his little bowler hats.
He's a chameleon, this Michael J. Fox. He could just fit into any role, man.
I think it would have been a different story or a different dynamic if they had Crispin Glover here, but I kind of like that. It's Michael J. Fox talking to himself, because he gives him, like, he's the one that is sort of the moral center of it, where he's like, you don't have to take these fights just because
you could have just walked away.
Yeah, you could just walk away.
Oh,
it just changes it a little bit, like on a weird meta level, if you were telling that to yourself. You know what I mean?
Sure.
I kind of like that.
So yeah, Maggie gives us the 411. We're on the McFly farm. She's married. William's a baby over there. Seamus is over there. He's got hats. And so they have dinner. It's rabbit that Seamus shot or whatever. William's the first McFly born in America. Not really key to the story, but just giving you a heads up. So they start eating dinner. And again, this is where I thought it was well done in terms of passing the food, grabbing the plates, pouring the water. The water's disgusting, of course. You want some water.
God.
You know what I mean? People did that, Tim. You
do
know
they
what
not
mean?
Have cheesecloths like to clean like the water? Bit.
I think their gut biome was so strong it could eat through any of the bacteria in that wire. That water. We're all wusses now.
Marty would be giving them all sorts of diseases and killing them, and they'd be giving Marty all sorts of diseases.
Oh, he would be giving them chicken pox, everything. Yeah. And yeah, he would probably shit himself to death if he had to go back and drink that water.
Oh no, totally. Yeah,
he would
definitely
get dysentery.
I would have loved it if the first American-born McFly, if they just used like Marty's head on the baby, like, if it was just Michael J. Fox's head, over.
They weren't falling on it.
Oh, it's horrifying.
Hey, Doc.
More information in exposition game here. And basically, he's got to get in town to find the blacksmith. I understand that. I can help you. Maggie doesn't like this and pulls him aside. But Seamus is like, I don't know what it is about this guy. But Will likes him, and Will doesn't like any strangers. I feel like my future is tied to him. And he offered because he offers him a hat as well.
It's interesting because this is the second time that comes up, right? Where a character interacts with the other character and feels something special about it. The first of which was when she kisses him in the car.
Yeah,
and she's like, that did not feel right.
Yeah.
And I love that there's like they never really have to explain that. They just introduce that element of like is something like some magic or some
maybe love travels through dimensions, you know what I mean?
Yeah, and you just recognize it.
Yeah. Andy, that's what I was saying.
And the one thing I don't love the way that those lines are delivered. They feel too cheesy and kind of convenient though. Like there's that moment at towards the end of the movie where Seamus McFly walks to the bar and he's like, I just feel like I had to be here, or like fate kind of brought me here. And it's like, it's so over, like, it's so in your face with it.
A little bit, but also you have to remember these two look exactly alike. If I saw someone that looked exactly like me who just happened into my space, I would be like, one of two things would happen. Either I'm like, I feel like I should take care of this human, or same matter can't occupy same space. Time kill cop, him. I have to kill it.
Yeah. And that's why you and Josh McCougar are such good friends. You went with the first
snap one. Its neck. Exactly. Yeah, want to take care of him. He has, you know.
It's funny that aside from
what does he have, Nick? What does he have? I was
gonna say, his liver one day is just gonna get up and leave. So we all have to love him while he's here.
We gotta
here.
Look out for him.
It's funny that Mad Dog's the only one that is like, hey, you and Seamus look a lot alike.
The Tannins have it can see through it. You know what I mean? They're connected to this timeline in a very interesting way.
Maggie or Margaret or whatever the hell her name was, wasn't Maggie. Like, hey, this guy looks just like you.
Well, they again, hats bullshit. And mustaches, it's hard. You know what I mean?
Sure. Yeah.
If Andy walks in and he's 10 years younger, with a different haircut, no mustache and a hat, you're not going to know who he is.
Not a chance.
You know what I mean? Anyways, so he'll take him as far as he can tomorrow. So Seamus drops him basically like the railroad tracks, and Marty walks his ass in there with a little bowler hat on. And here we go. It's Hill Valley 1885, right? And so he's walking around. He's taking in the sights. There's some whores. There's some
tombstone guy.
Tombstones. They're cutting up food out there. They're bathing a dude. And everybody's just looking at Marty because he looks weird.
I'm going to ask this. Stupid. Who do you think runs this town, and is he good with the town's payers, good with the good people of Hills Valley's money? Because we have five shops and a mega structure with a clock in it that must have cost $500,000 to make back then.
Well, if I
were in this town, I'd be like, maybe more horse stables or some clean water would be where we start.
Clean water.
But this is, you know, it's going to stand for all time, as they'll tell you later, and it's going to be important to the town. Yeah, and they're raising money for it still.
Spot on, you know what I mean?
Who the fuck are they raising money? There's 15 people that live in this town. Are they giving them all of their income?
Oh, I forgot too. Marty told everybody his name's Clint Eastwood.
That's awesome.
Literally 130 years into the future, this tower, the clock tower, is still there.
Yeah, still there.
In every scenario.
Yeah.
I guess we don't see it in 1985. We do with Biff controlling everything?
1985? Oh, I don't know about that.
In alternate reality, 85, Biff, I think, tore it down and put up the toxic waste plant.
Right, the hotel where they live. But so for most timelines, it's pretty solid.
Totally.
Not bad for this mayor that we met for like 2 seconds.
Clint Eastwood was asked for permission for his name being used for Marty, and he consented and was said to be tickled by the homage. Can you imagine Clint Eastwood being like, I'm tickled.
That's amazing. That's really cool. I always wondered if they had to actually go to him and get permission. I mean, you assume, sure, but it's just his name. I don't know what the rights are on that versus the likeness.
Well, it used his likeness in two, remember, because they're watching the movie. Now, granted, that's some kind of movie deal, I assume. Sure. Where it's like,
yeah, they call up the other studio, or if it's their studio, they can just get the rights to it. But they just pay a small fee for the licensing, like a song for that.
Do you think there's a lot of young kids who don't even know who Clint Eastwood is?
Yeah.
Well, he's a really good director now, right?
Well, yeah. He directs.
They don't know him in this sense, right?
Sure.
But you, like, I mean, like a 13-year-old growing up right now.
Oh, they don't know who Clint Eastwood is. No, right. Absolutely not a chance. They're not watching freaking Gran Torino and being like this moving piece.
It's funny you picked Gran Torino, which is like one of the most recent movies that he's done.
That's what I'm saying. They don't watch like they're not watching like American Sniper or any of the movies he's doing now. I don't think kids give a shit about the stuff he's doing now. But like back in the day,
I don't even think
fucking Dirty Harry. Damn right,
he needs to make a Fortnite movie. You know?
Yeah, 100%.
I know what you're. I know, Greg. I know what you're thinking to yourself. Did he have five bullets or six? Did he shoot six or five? Well, to tell you the truth, in all the chaos, I don't know myself. So I guess you have to ask yourself: do you feel lucky?
Do you feel lucky?
Well, do you, punk?
That's Dirty Harry for all the kids watching.
Damn.
Has anyone watched that movie?
I've never seen Dirty Harry.
Oh, Nick, it's on Netflix.
I've never seen it. I've never even seen the scene. But I kind of felt like I knew where you were getting to.
Dude, you guys should watch Dirty Harry. That's iconic.
Yeah.
Dirty Harry is Clint Eastwood interview. Let's
fucking
go.
Awesome. Harry Callahan.
So he walks in town, he sees all the shit, he's looking around for the blacksmith, he don't see shit, he sees the clock tower and sees how it's still out there and it's not built yet, and he's like, wow, this is fucked up, Doc. And so he goes into the bar. And there's a bunch of old timers there, including I think Andy Rooney, right? Mickey Rooney? No, Andy Rooney.
I don't know, but all I know is that Greg, if you and me were in this bar, guess which characters we'd be.
The guys, there's not that many people in the bar. I'm assuming we're the guys at the table.
There's just two guys at the table that are Waldorf and Statler the entire time, who are just making fun of him relentlessly.
That's what I'm talking about. Isn't that Andy Rooney?
That's what I
was
want.
Mickey Rooney?
Mickey Rooney's the guy.
Like Mickey Rooney's alive and still making.
Andy Rooney was the. You know what really grinds my gears? Wasn't that Andy Rooney? Yeah, I don't know. Shit. I didn't recognize him.
Well, no. So who's the dude I'm thinking of? There's an old actor, Rooney, right?
Mick Rooney. Andy Rooney is.
It is Mickey Rooney,
right? Oh, Mickey Rooney. That's what it is. Yeah.
So wait, who is the wrestler? Who wants his bird?
Mickey Rourke.
Thank you. That's where I'm getting hung up.
What are you talking about?
I was gonna say, Andy Rooney was like a 60-minute correspondent, right?
Andy Rooney is correspondent. Mickey Rooney is the old-timey actor who's in the Simpsons for the fall.
And he was in a Back to the Future as well. Right, the guy who ran the movie theater, or no, not Last Action Hero.
Oh, that might have been him. Yeah,
great movie. Also.
And then here we go. Okay, cool. So we're caught up then. Everybody's fine. Got it. Perfect. Great. But I'm looking at the thing. I don't see Mickey Rooney on here. Do I not know who Mickey Rooney is, Kevin?
I didn't recognize Mickey Rooney in this. But I wasn't really paying that close attention as they were just utterly eviscerating Marty McFly as he walks.
No,
in.
That looks like Mickey Rooney. Hold on, Mickey Rooney.
I can look it up for you, Greg. While you do this.
I'm looking.
Well,
no,
I can't move on. You know what I mean?
It's impossible to keep going now.
Mom, fuck. Maybe that's not him. I don't know Mickey Rooney.
Well, I'm happy to get you, man.
I don't fucking know who Mickey Rooney is.
So yeah, the old timers in the saloon were Pat Buttram, Harry Carey Jr.
And Dub Taylor. Who, these guys all have to be famous, like old Western.
Dude. Oh, I'm sure they are. I'm sure they.
Oh, look at that! I thought that Dub Taylor was Mickey Rooney. So, and this is like legitimately directly connected to your question of does anybody know who the fuck Clint Eastwood is at 13? Watching these movies, I'm like, oh, this old white guy must be that other old white guy I've heard about.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I saw him on The Simpsons, and this guy looks like the guy from The Simpsons. So that's not fair.
He looks a lot like what I would think Mickey Rooney looks like. If you put them next to each other, I wouldn't be able to tell you which one was which, but I don't know a lot about Mickey Rooney.
Wow, look at that. We learned something today, except what Mickey Rooney actually looks like, but I digress. He walks into the bar.
He doesn't look like Mickey Rourke.
So for context, Dub Taylor was in Maverick, Bonnie and Clyde, The Wild Bunch, and The Getaway, so he must have been like an old school.
These are old-time Western actors, I assumed. Yeah. He walks up to
Designing Women. He was in a couple Designing Women.
Talks to the bartender and is like, yo, I'm looking, can I get some ice water? And they all laugh at him. And he's like, you want some water? Better duck your head in the horse trough. He's like, fucking Jesus. Here we serve whiskey. And he puts out the little shot glass and he pours it and it steams off the table because it's eating through it like crazy.
So I love that.
It's absurd.
I never noticed that until this time watching this. I'm like, really? Wow, that was a cool effect. I never noticed that it overflows and hits the dry ice or whatever the fuck chemical they put on the bar.
But he's obviously they're looking for the blacksmith before he can really formulate that plan. However, Mad Dog Tannen rides into town. He comes on in here and he's like, McFly, I thought you're not Seamus McFly, but you wear his dumb hat. You know what I mean? We're getting this whole situation over here.
Greg, I want you to know that I burst into laughter randomly by myself a couple days ago, thinking of you doing the impression, unless you got power.
Unless you got power. Still the best. So some good. Of the best line delivery in cinema. Fuck you, Mickey Rooney. So they get into an altercation here, right? where he calls him Mad Dog Tannen. He's like, I don't like being called Mad Dog Tannen. Why would you do that? And then he pulls out his gun and he says, dance. He starts shooting the floor. And then Marty goes from being terrified to like, I'm just going to Michael Jackson dance.
Which I'm going to moonwalk and sing Michael Jackson songs.
Yeah.
All right.
So this is so dumb. I hated it.
He confuses everyone at the bar and then decides to grow a pair and slams down on a loose plank, kicks over a spittoon. It lands in Mad Dog's arms. And Marty's like, so that's gross. Fucking gross. I better run. And it's our
no, he doesn't go. One of the other guys goes, you better run, son.
Well, yeah.
But get the fuck out of here.
So he runs outside. And you'd think it's going to be your normal Back to the Future. We're going to get a skateboard, but it's all dirt roads, right, Nick? You got no skateboards out there.
No, you ain't got skateboards, bro.
And so he's running. And then Mad Dog Tannen and the gang get on their horses, and they lasso Marty. And then they start dragging Marty through the streets. And it's terrifying. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because we love Michael J. Fox. We think we love Michael J. Fox. And while he's not as sexy as he was in Back to the Future 1, he's still pretty fucking sexy. Why? And so you don't want to see this sexy
I just don't know
boy
if he was
get
ever
killed.
Sexy.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so he gets dragged around. They drag him over to the courthouse. And then he's like, we got a new courthouse. I think it's about time for a hanging. And they fucking wrap it around his neck and he's like, and then they fucking hang him. And they got, there's just a fucking hook there for no reason. They're like, eh. They're doing this whole thing. You know what I mean? And then everybody's like, oh man, this is traditional old West stuff. This makes sense.
It's worth noting, by the way, also that we saw a sign at the Marshall that said off for the so-and-so hanging. So
oh, right. Yeah, Marshall yeah. Marshall's out of town right at the moment.
Because I always wondered when I was a kid, like, why the fuck are the cops? The Marshall place is, like, right next door. How come the cops don't come out and stop us?
I mean, you watch Tombstone. That whole town's fucked anyway. So it doesn't
love, I love that the Marshall is Strickland.
Yeah, it's so good.
Because, like, and the character's different enough that it's like, God, I could see this being the great-grandfather of that man.
Yeah, you broke up a bit there, Kev. We understood. Worth pointing out, too, that I think this is the first time we ride by the manure. Or actually, we might have walked by it when we came into town. And it's A. Jones instead of D. Jones, like in the 1955 manure company.
Oh, that's cool.
Same thing with it's also a funny one, too, of if you remember, and this is a deep cut from all the other ones, but like Statler Toyota was a thing, and Statler Automotive has been a thing throughout all the timelines of Hill Valley. This time it's Statler horses when Marty walks in. So like that Statler family.
Oh, that's cool. I like that.
For Hill Valley forever.
Man, people Marty's really don't leave this fucking town ever, do they?
No, right. Well, I mean, that's what it used to be about in the 80s. You remember that. People had
another fun thing for you guys here. So each of Needle's henchmen comes from one of the other gangs in the trilogy. So this is at the end of the movie, but it makes sense to talk about here because we just saw some of
these
guys.
The Avengers gang or whatever.
So J.J. Cohen played Skinhead in Biff's gang in Back to the Future 1 and 2. Ricky Dean Logan played Data in Griff's gang in Back to the Future 2.
That's
cool. Christopher Wynn played an unnamed member of Buford's gang in this one. Cohen appeared
all the ones in Needle's car.
Yeah,
that's cool. That's really cool.
So is Needle's a Tannen?
No, I think Needles is just Needles, just man. Friend,
remember how we were trying to connect who's Griff's dad? Maybe it's Needles. I'm just saying.
No, awesome. According to the TV show, it's Griff Jr.
I apologize.
Thank
you very much.
No problem.
Are we going to interview that? Because by the TV show, you mean the cartoon, right?
Yeah. Is that not on TV?
I mean, it was, it but show? I don't know if that's like canon. Because there was a great episode where Doc invented a baseball structure exoskeleton you could wear and be good at baseball. And I remember when Marty wore that and went to the major leagues. It was a big deal.
Canon.
Kind of a ripoff of Rookie of the Year, but nobody cared.
Such a big deal. But before we get on with the plot, I want to tell you guys about ExpressVPN. So here's the thing, man. We all know about how ExpressVPN protects your privacy and security online. But there's something that you might not know. And in these trying times, this is something that you should know. You can also use ExpressVPN to unlock movies and shows that are only available in other countries. Now that so many of us are stuck at home, it's only a matter of time until you run out of everything to watch on Netflix. You can only blade through the same content for so long. You need new content to be able to blade through. So this whole week, forever, whenever you want, you can use ExpressVPN to binge shows like Doctor Who, which is only available on the UK Netflix. But if you're in America, you can do this. Next thing you know, Kevin, what are you doing?
Watching some Doctor Who.
You're watching Doctor Who, man. ExpressVPN hides your IP address and lets you control where you want sites to think that you're located. You can choose from almost 100 different countries. So just think about all the Netflix libraries you can go through. If you love anime, go to fucking... Whoa. Go to Japan, guys. Go to Japan. Japanese Netflix and be spirited away. You get it? Huh? That was fun there. It's not just Netflix. ExpressVPN works with any streaming service like Hulu, BBC iPlayer, YouTube, you name it. There are hundreds of VPNs out there, but the reason that you want to use ExpressVPN to watch shows is that it's ridiculously fast. There's never any buffering or lag, and you can stream in HD, no problemo. ExpressVPN is also compatible with all your devices, phones, media consoles, smart TVs, and more. If you visit the link right now, You can go to expressvpn.com/morning. You can get an extra 3 months of ExpressVPN for free. You can support this show, watch what you want, and protect yourself with ExpressVPN at expressvpn.com/morning. That's expressvpn.com/morning. And if you visit that, you can get an extra 3 months for free. How about that? How about that?
There you have it.
Got through that okay?
Smooth enough.
Did you though? You
know what I mean? Back to the plot.
Marty is being hung. It all looks like this is how the movie will end, with a dead teenager in 1885. Jesus. You're ready for it. You know what I mean? There's some blood coming out of his eyes. You're ready for this. And instead, what do you get? Somebody walks up with a really cool looking gun. And then they extend the scope of it. And then they hold it up and they shoot, and Marty falls. They shot right through the rope. That's a crazy shot. How could they do that?
So
and the
cool.
Buford gang freaks out, and they look over that, and it's Doc. It's Doc. Everybody's like, Tannen! It can shoot a flea off a dog at 300 yards.
So cool. What a great thing to say.
Put his gun down or whatever. And then they have this whole argument here about this fucking thing. And it's funny. You know what I mean? Because here's the thing. Griff sucked. We hated Griff, right? Mm-hmm. He's weird. Like, he's weird. He's got a meat fucking head. We didn't like that thing that pounds meat.
You didn't like the tenderizer, the Bart head?
No, I didn't like the. I love that. We hate that. All right, it's weird. Again, all the respect in the world to the Thomas F. Wilson and all this characterization he has to do to make fucking the same dude different every fucking movie.
There are so many emote possibilities with the faces you're making when you do the characters.
But Buford Gang is fun. We like him a lot. And so he argues with Doc, and it's about this horse that threw its shoes or whatever, and it's been you can bring him back and you can reshoot him. Well, I killed the horse after it happened. So there's this whole funny exchange, and like this is the $80, of course, that will lead to Doc getting shot in the back. And so they have this whole argument, and finally he's like, all right, fine, fuck you guys, yeah, I'm out of here, but you know, you'll pay for this eventually, you stupid blacksmith. And they ride off, and then Doc goes over there to Marty, and he's like, and they pick him up, and he's like, I told you not to come back for me, but it's good to see you. And they hug, and Marty's all he can't talk, you know what I mean? And he's like, what kind of idiot dressed you like this? You did. And then they go back to Doc's hideout or whatever, right?
It's a great line. I love that moment,
right? Great. And this is the whole thing again, like in the same way Uncharted 3 worked so well because it was like this buddy movie between Sully and Drake. It's the same thing here, where I do like the Doc Marty, like it's different. It's the same, obviously, things we're doing, but it is different enough that like, hey, here they are interacting and actually showing the friendship that they have.
They are very much
later. We have the line where they flip catchphrases, and like it's just a fun little thing where you know, one says it's heavy and it's great Scott, whatever. But it's like, I like that because it really is saying like, look, Doc is the main focal point of this movie. Like he is the star of this. I like that a lot.
Yeah, like these little back and forth that we're getting between them, it's just shown how much that they've been through already, and they understand that. And it just reminds you a lot of, again, we keep making Avengers comparisons, but it reminds you of like Cap and Tony, like just giving each other shit, and they're all buddy buddy. It's really cute.
So we go back to the blacksmith shop. We're going to catch up, see what's happening. Marty walks him through. Here's the picture. You're going to get shot in the back by Tannen. Doc's like, yeah, man, if I knew this, I would have just paid him off. Who's Clara? I don't know Clara. I've never met a Clara. I'm not in love with anybody. That's crazy. And it's like, all right, cool. Well, you're right, Marty. We just have to go back then. We'll go back to 1985. And Doc makes a whole point of like, he's been staying on the down low and he wouldn't have a romantic connection because he doesn't want to fuck with the timeline. He thought he was trapped here, he's doing his best not to upset the apple cart, even though he's taking over a shop that would have been somebody else's shop. But I digress. Let's not get there.
Also, he's created ice, like he's made a refrigerator.
Oh, but he's not sharing that. That's
earlier. This is where it happens. Yeah, where he's figured out how to make ice. This is going to be super simple. And Doc's packing up all his stuff. He's like, this is going to be super simple. And then Marty's like, oh, by the way, my reentry here, we tore the fuel line. And this is, you know, we're going to have to fill it up with gas. And Doc immediately is just like, it's over. They overcome so much. And Doc's just like, there's no possible way to fix this.
It's interesting. I feel like he doesn't know how to figure out how to make gas from oil.
Yeah, but he only has like 5 days. That's my only ration. That's my only like defense against this. I think he could have done that. I think he could have done a conversion for the thing to ethanol. I think he could have done a lot of different things. But I think they're desperate. And then of course, once they do that, they blow out the fuel injector,
right? Because like, again, Nick,
fuck everything up. Yeah.
Because again, Nick, they decide to go back 5 minutes before the big thing's about to happen.
Yeah, exactly. Just give yourself 5 months.
A little leeway, you know.
Here's the thing, he's stupid, you know. Marty's not a smart guy. Oh, yeah.
But Doc agrees with him. He's like, we should go back 5 days. Doc's like, sure, that sounds right.
This kid's coming from the fucking future to go save him in the past. It's actually his future. Doc's confused.
For Christ's sake, do you guys ever have to come back and you ever have to come back and save me from 1885? Give it a solid 6 months.
No.
Let's take a vacay. Like, let's hang out.
You have to go on.
Bring some money with you so we can like buy some horses and like horse race and do some cool shit.
Dance to ZZ Top.
Exactly.
Oh my God! What K-Babs on TV here says actually something smart. Is that Marty arrived when he did so that Doc could write the letter to Marty. But again, he could have still written that letter with Marty being like, "All right, write the letter. This is what you say." The letter. You know what I mean,
Kevin? You know it's kebabs, right?
Anyway, so they're there, and this is the revelation that they, well, without gasoline, we can't get it to 80 miles per hour. We're going to fuck it all up. I'm going to combine a few things here because I can't remember exactly where it happened.
They try alcohol first, and then it blows.
Thank you, Nick, for fucking the point up. That wasn't the point I was making.
And then I think the governor comes in and asks him to.
Oh, that's my point. Is this when the mayor comes in and is like, hey, you have to, you know how to
pick up the, yeah.
You said you pick up the teacher or whatever. And he's like, oh, fuck me. Anyways, yeah, they try the alcohol, the strongest stuff they have in the bar that blows out the fuel injector. They try dragging it behind horses. That doesn't get nearly fast enough. There's talk of rolling it down a big hill, waiting till winter when it's ice and there'll be no friction, all stuff. But that's back to Kebab's point that they don't have enough time, right? Or maybe it was the other point. Our point that they have to get out of there by Monday. Like
the shot of it being dragged by the horses was so freaking cool.
Yeah,
that
was
cool.
Right. Yeah, it was really, really cool.
Real scared for that windshield, though.
They're going to fall through that thing. Who knows if it was safety glass back then? It might have just been a pane of glass.
Yeah, it probably was a pane of glass thicker.
They're worried about it, and they're Doc's ready to give up again. And if only there's something, and then he hears the train whistle blowing. Toot toot. He's like, oh fuck, shit, fuck. And so him and Marty run over there, and they're talking to the conductor about how fast they could get it up there. And the guy's like, I think what did he say, 25? And there's a guy who got it at 30 on a long stretch of thing or whatever. And then they ask about 90, and the guy's like, what? It's impossible. Nothing can go 90 miles an hour. And they're like, no, I just settle a bet here, you know. And he's like, well, if you had nothing behind you, if you had a long straightaway track and you could get that boiler hotter than the depths of Hades, you might have a shot at it or whatever.
This like, scene fell flat to me where what? Like it felt like just pure exposition. I feel like they could have done something more clever of like having these people be somebody we know or something. I don't know, just like it kind of just felt like, all right, now here's the exact exposition of what needs to happen here. I just feel like it could have been more fun,
like Dale Earnhardt Jr. or something back in the, you know, like he knows speed, you know.
This guy knows speed,
like these Tom guys Cruise. Knows fast, you know. Yeah,
I don't know, I kind of liked it. I was like, if you're gonna ask who how fast a train can go, who better to ask than the actual conductor of the train? The only thing I don't like is I'm like, I don't understand why you couldn't. I know that they had to have the thing beyond the straightaway, but another perfect example of like, why do they always just calculate it out? So this thing hits 88 miles per hour the second it goes over the fucking gorge.
That's what it had
why
to
not?
Yeah, I think that's the straightaway they had, Nick.
But I feel like you could it was just a slight bend. Why don't you just start half a mile back and just get up to at least 20 miles an hour so you get a running start with this thing in front of it?
What if Tim? How about
get 10 miles an hour? Why are you starting from zero?
He's asking the guy about like speed and you know how fast can this train go? And he goes, by the way, what's your name? And he goes, Dominic Toretto.
Oh my God! Can you
like
imagine?
Or like a name of that sort of, you know what I mean?
You're
like,
right, Andy. I don't think back in 1990 they had
Mario Andretti.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I don't know if they knew that fast.
Fran Mirabella the first.
Yeah, exactly.
Here's my other question to you. Do you guys think that wouldn't it be possible that when they return back to 1985, Doc Brown and Clint Eastwood are known as domestic terrorists? Yeah, because it's clearly them that took that train. And they just, for no reason, took hundreds of thousands of dollars worth of train and just drove it over a fucking cliff. Domestic terrorists.
And we respected them. They have, you know, they know about Mad Dog Buford-Tin. I digress. From there, I'm going to toss this in, but I'm a little hazy if this is exactly. I think maybe they ride horses to look at the tracks and figure it all out and be like, yeah, this will work, whatever. And then they hear a woman screaming and like, what's that woman screaming? Right. And you look up there and there's a carriage and it's run away and there's a lady in purple on it. And they're like, we got to do something, Marty. And so he's like, come on, Marty. They're riding, they're having a great time, but they're really scared. And so this horse is headed right for the ravine, right? Like Clayton Ravine, which we've already talked about. Also, Clara Clayton, we already found out her name earlier, and that's when they're like, oh, fuck, that's the woman you're supposed to fall in love with, but I won't fall in love with her. Don't worry about it. They ride over there. Doc gets up beside it. He pulls her off the carriage. She gets on. The horses break free just at the right time for the carriage to tumble over the side with all of its flour she was carrying. It's fucking just flour flying everywhere, and it smashes down and destroys all our books, and all the kids are like, yay, we don't have to learn ever again. those were the only books in the old
West. She's left with this indestructible telescope.
Well, no, because they do it and they get introduced. It's love at first sight, obviously, on the horse. And she's all like, oh, he's all like, oh, and they're like, you know what I mean? They're in love with each other kind of thing. But Marty, Doc and Clara ride on one horse and Marty rides on the other one. And they ride her back to her place of residence now. And they have a bunch of loose clothes and some loose boxes and a loose telescope in its box. Mm-hmm. And they drop it there. And Doc is up there and he can't stop staring at her. And she can't stop staring at them. And they're fucking in love. You can tell they're in love, like me and Genevieve. But Marty keeps doing the Doc thing of like interrupting. Like, we got to go, Doc. Time to go, Doc. We got to get out of here, Doc. And he's like, yeah, we have to go, blah, blah. And so like, he kind of reveals he's a scientist here. And she gets all excited. I'm a student of all scientists. Yeah, exactly. And so they ride back. And it's just like, oh, it was just being nice, Marty, kind of thing. And it's like, oh, it's more than being nice. You know what I mean? Marty also said this out was for him and Jennifer. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Like, you looked horny, Doc, you know?
Yeah, it's the first time Doc's blood's ever worked down there, you know what
I
mean?
Yeah.
Because before, he only got erections for science. I'm sorry, what was that?
You think Doc's been a virgin?
Yeah.
This is the first time.
I think he was dedicated to his craft, you know what I mean?
Even been close to a woman?
He's been close to him before, science conventions.
I think that's a good point. I don't think it says something he ever strived for. I do think that, he was dedicated to his craft and his career, you know?
Yeah. And so, all right, cool, that's the end of that. We're all right, we got that done or whatever. And then now we're back in the barn. Where he's got a crude model once again. Yeah, sorry Marty for the crudity of this model.
I love that
scale. Yeah, it's amazing.
It still reminds me of part one, like, and I giggled to myself again.
Totally.
Sorry about the crude model, like, it's fine. It's good.
it's not the scale painted. Yeah, what we talked about again is the exact same thing here, right? Of like, all right, cool, we're gonna steal the train here, release all the cargo and passengers, then we'll flip this track, we'll go over here, the time machine, DeLorean will be here, we'll put it in here, we're gonna have to get it really hot, so I've made these crazy logs that burn really hot. I use them in my forge or whatever to do things faster. And then, you know, as Nick said, when we get to this very this is where it was, and we get to this this deadly drop that isn't built yet, but you're not thinking forward dimensionally enough, Marty. Yeah, I've got a real problem with that. The bridge will exist in 1985. You'll just glide right across. Everything will be fine. That's what I think when they hear Clara, but it doesn't matter. While they were, I'm just mixing and matching now, I guess. Sorry. But anyways, at some point in the barn, Clara shows up with her telescope. It got broken. Can you help me out, Doc? He's like, yeah, and like this. And then you go this way. It's perfectly clear. And there's another moment where everything's clear to them because they're in love now, kind of thing.
I do love all this because it's so reflective of, I guess, in part one where Marty's mom is coming on to him in the lab or whatever, or in Doc's little hut or whatever. And I love, you know, but this time we're looking at Marty kind of doing like the, oh,
he's
shit.
Walking around like, we got to do this, Doc. This is what it's about kind of thing, right? And so the idea is this, he can fix it for her. He won't charge her for it. Oh, great. I can pick it up from you tonight at the, not the Enchantment Under the Sea dance, but the town festival or whatever for the clock tower. And they're like, oh, we weren't going to go because of time travel, but okay, we'll go. You know what I mean? Like,
because of time travel.
Time travel was going to keep our pee-pees in our pants, Meemaw, but now we
won't. Meemaw,
meet Grandpapa.
God, why do we have to
do it? Because I want a Meemaw shirt. Andy, make it.
It's never going to happen.
Instead of it being my black shirt with a KF on the side, I want Meemaw on the side.
That's exactly right, Greg.
Thank you. I'm glad Nick's here to party.
Can we do a shirt that is Nick from the Golden Girls thing? You know, the makeup that he did?
Yeah.
And then on it just says, your Meemaw loves you?
Yeah, I love it.
Okay,
that's
cool.
That's
great. It's a combo one. It's me, but it says Meemaw's watching.
I think your Meemaw loves you, and it's you dressed up as Blanche or whatever.
It's a spoof of my grandma's shirt.
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
It's okay.
Anyways, now we're going to go to this fucking town festival or whatever. And so they have to go out of love now. Okay, fine. So Marty and Doc go over there, and this is where he has ZZ Top's playing.
So the thing here is ZZ Top was just, they were by the set. Like, they were doing some performance thing, like some rock show. I know it's a foreign thing to think about at this point in time, but they were doing that and it was nearby and they came by the set just to like see things. And they're like, hey, do you want to like hang out? And they started playing music and then they got put in the movie.
Awesome.
That's cool.
That's really cool. And so it's
really fly by the seat of their pants in these movies, man. Like,
It sucks that Huey Lewis didn't make songs for 2 and 3, but I digress.
Yeah, because here's what I wanted. Here's what I wanted. Point. The song that I was playing at this dance, I would have loved it if it was just a Western version of The Power of Love.
And it turns out, like, violin and shit. It turns out that Huey Lewis is also a time traveler, and he steals that song. Whoa. You know what I mean? Cool. Bill and Ted are there with Huey Lewis, and they're like, check out this sound, bro.
He's writing a letter. Check out the sound.
it's a happening festival. There's a lot of shit going on. It looks pretty cool. The clock. They do the whole thing of starting the clock for the clock tower. The mayor does it, and he's not Goldie Wilson Jr. -3 or whatever. Everybody's like, yeah, and then it's like, all right. And like they're having this whole conversation. It's just like, yeah, I forget how Marty sets it up. Is just, you know, sucks when I have a picture of it or us or anything like that. And then they flash the bulb. So they go over there and pose by the clock, take the photo. It's another funny, I think, you know, like bro moment for them, right? Where Doc's like, it sucks we won't be able to show this to anybody. And Marty's like, just smile, Doc. They take the photo together. Then they go over to the dance thing, right? They're hanging out there on the Clara shows up, she starts talking to Emmett, they're gonna dance.
We get a scene with a gun
or Doc gets distracted by Clara, and Marty walks off to the arcade in quotes cabinet to the Colt testing facility. He shoots really shitty, and then he's like, can I try that again? He does his crack shot shit from
the guy's like, no, you gotta hold it with your left hand. I'm like, what the fuck? And Marty's big secret is he's like, I'm right-handed.
Nobody sees so that stupid. Coming. Meanwhile, on the outside of the...
I love that, like, the payoff from the second movie, seeing that, like, him be really good at that arcade and seeing it now. It's like, oh, look, they set it up. Have fun.
Yeah, I don't know if it's worth it, though.
No, I
feel like it's like, oh, there's a payoff, but it's like, all right, then I'm just not had it in either movie.
Well, I just like it because there wouldn't have been no tension.
Marty's gun skills, he should probably just kill...
Totally,
Mad Dog Tannen. Yeah.
It's a bizarre thing to set up that doesn't have a payoff of him actually.
I think it does, because I think that it shows him as skilled, but then it serves to show how much more dangerous Mad Dog is. Because remember, at the end, he's like, he looks at the picture and he still loses. So he's like, I might go out there, I'm dead, like no matter what. So true. I think him up as a skilled gunman, but it sets Biff up as way more dangerous.
But I don't know, at no point even before then was he confident he was going to win this fight with the gun.
No, but the audience looks at it and goes, oh, this guy, he can shoot, so he has a fighting chance. If he couldn't shoot for shit, if we'd ever show that he could actually shoot, then there would be no tension going in as to whether, right. Like, there's no way, but like, there's no way.
I don't know. I feel like it convolutes the tension.
I'm kind of with Tim. I wish he just didn't have it in either movie.
I think it makes it so that there is like the potential that there's a fair fight, like Nick said.
Yeah, you lead into the third act going, you don't know what Marty's going to do. Whereas if we never saw him handle a gun,
you would know that fighting isn't an option.
It's not an option. This one, you're like, oh, it is an option. And because he doesn't like to be called a coward, he's going to go out there and that's going to get the better of him. And that leads to that pivotal moment where he has to make that decision to not let people, you know, get in the way of his destiny. I do want to give a quick shout out to the fact that the production design behind the cabinet looks like the old game where like the hearts are right here and like they flip around as he shoots them. That was a cool little detail they paid attention to.
And yeah, worth pointing out, when Mad Dog got him in the fight before, he called him yellow, and that was why he didn't
yellow
water or whatever. So now Doc's dancing. Meanwhile, on the outside, Tannen's gang had showed up. Marshall Strickland had been there when they confiscated all their weapon. He had his son with him and was like, don't let anybody push you around, you know what I mean? Basically, look out for slackers. But Mad Dog turned over all their guns except for one, just a one-shot little pistol.
That he keeps in his hat.
Right. When they were there, they saw Doc over there dancing with Clara. And so they went over there to approach him. While they're approaching, Marty's already done with the gun game, and he's instead going over to the pie table, and he runs into the McFly family there, and they talk for a little bit. And then Marty just fucking gorilla eats a piece of pie. And he's like, oh, Frisbee, far out. Which is a funny line, period. And then like the McFly's reaction of like, what, that was a strange thing to say.
This kid ate a lot of lead. Now, do you think that if they started a pie business, they'd call it McFly's Pies?
I hope so.
It's cool. Possible, Nick. It's possible. Yeah.
So now over there, Doc and Claire are dancing, and Tannen comes up and puts the gun in the back of Doc, and he's like, "I'm gonna fucking kill you." And Doc's like, "You're early." And I thought this is a great line, like, right? Like, "Oh, you're early." And he's like, "Last time I shot somebody with this gun, it took 2 days for them to bleed out and die." And I was like, "Oh, that's why he dies on Monday, shot in the back. They were all ready for a fight on Monday, but actually, it's something that happens on Saturday." That's
I never caught that.
Yeah,
that's cool. That's cool.
So yeah, Doc's like, "Oh, I'm gonna talk some shit or whatever." And then he's like, "You won't fucking talk shit to me." And then he's like, "Oh wait, you're dancing with a woman. I want to dance with a woman." And he goes back to being like, again, just being a sexual predator runs in the Tannen family. And he does the same like bit face, like grabbing her and dancing around. They're like, "And no." And then like Doc mouths off or something, and he's like, "All right, that's it. I'm gonna fucking kill you." And so he pulls out the gun. Marty sees it. He grabs the frisbee pie plate, throws it at it, knocks the gun out. He still shoots, but he just hits Doc's hat, and the hat flies off. And then somebody over there is like, "I'm from Frisbee Pies. This seems like a cool toy we should make." And they're like, "Oh, this will change the world." But they cut that scene out.
Instead, true story about frisbees.
Is it?
That's how frisbees came to be. It was Frisbee was a pie company.
Yeah.
And then some kids in college at UPenn, I think it was, started throwing it around. And then they're like, "Oh, shit." And then so Frisbee started making – I'm not making this up.
That's cool.
Does it go that far? Kevin's giving me the face that I'm making this up.
It seems like – because sometimes you'll throw fucking made-up shit at us and you'll be like,
I could totally tell it was real because I don't know. It was so weird hearing Tim say the word UPenn.
Yeah, he doesn't know what UPenn is. There's no way Tim thinks about UPenn.
He went to UPenn.
But here's the thing. Didn't Gia go to somewhere? Is it Pittsburgh?
Yeah, that's what he just said.
I thought she went to Philadelphia.
That's what he just said, yeah.
Oh, I didn't hear it.
But wait, didn't Gia go to a college like that? Anyway. You know what I mean? Anyways, now Marty runs over there and he's like, "Fuck off, man." And he's like, "You fuck off, man. I was going to kill this guy." And he's like, "Well, fuck you." And they're like, "Fuck you." And so Marty starts to walk. "I just want you to leave my friends alone. I just want you to leave my friends alone." And so he turns to walk away. And then Tannen's like, "What are you, yellow again?" Or some shit like that. And he's like, "No." And they come over and they're like, "Oh, let's fucking fight. What are we doing tomorrow?" And this is another funny scene where you're like, "You know what, Mad Dog Tannen? You're a caged sexual predator and a murderer, but I still like your style." And he's like, "What about tomorrow?" "I can't do it tomorrow, Mad Dog. You gotta fucking whatever the hell. We're robbing the town or whatever. What about the next day? We can do it on Monday. All right, cool. I want to do it at 7 a.m. or whatever." And they're out.
By the
way,
I like the callback of like whatever they did the next day is what they get arrested for later.
Right.
Where he's like, Strickland comes and goes, "You're under arrest for robbing the whatever train."
Yeah.
"Oh, cool. That's fun."
And so, like, I like to get my killing done before breakfast. And Marty says noon. I like to get it done before. They settle on 8. And Doc's like, "Marty." And he's like, "We're going to be fucking gone at 8, you idiot. Shut up." And he's like, "Yeah, let's do it. Great. That's the thing." And so, you know, Tannen walks up. Or no, Marshall shows up and talks some shit. And then Tannen walks off. And then Seamus comes over and he's like, "All you had to do was walk away. You could have walked away now for me like a child." And they're like, "No, I couldn't walk away, man. Just fucking call me a chicken."
Also, I couldn't walk away because this guy would just have shot me in the back.
Yeah, well, someone's got to put this guy down.
I don't think saying no to this guy was going to stop him, you know?
Exactly.
Like, fuck off, Seamus McParty McFly.
And then fucking Doc's like, "Marty, what the fuck?" He's like, "We'll be gone at 8 a.m. He's like, "What if anything goes wrong? What if the train's late?" He's like, "Train's late." And then more people are like, "Good job, Mr. Eastwood. Get him, Mr. Eastwood. Blah, blah, Mr. Eastwood." And the gun guy's like, "I want you to take this gun because if whatever gun kills him, I want him. And if you lose, I'll take it back." And I'm like, "All right, cool. You get it. You got
what an influencer at this point in time."
Totally, right? The first influencer kids call him.
Yeah.
So Marty goes home. Doc and Clara go to her house and use the binocular, not the binocular, the telescope that he just fixed or whatever. Doc stays out all night long and comes back smelling Clara's little thing.
I like the little conversation they have here, where she's like, "Do you think we'll ever be able to go to space?" And he gives her the spiel of it. And she goes, "I've read that book too." And he goes, "What are you talking about? Jules Verne." And he goes, "I love that. My favorite was like 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. I read that when I was a kid." She's like, how could you have read that when you were a kid? It came out like 12 months ago or something like that.
10 years ago. Yeah.
10 years ago. I felt like I was a kid. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Really,
really cute scene. And also shout out to Mary Steenburgen. Bergen. Yeah. Mary Steenburgen. That's how you say her last name, right?
I never can. That's why I have it in front of me. Mary
Steinberg. Anyway, love her and Curb Your Enthusiasm as Ted Danson's real and fictional wife in the show.
Mom from Step Brothers.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Yeah, she's phenomenal. And they have really good chemistry, the two of them. Like, you believe that he would want to stay back in time with her.
Yep. Marty wakes up the next day. Doc never came home. Marty's got his butt hanging out. He walks over there, does the whole, "Are you talking to me?"
He does.
Have a gun.
Also, fun little homage to the opening of the original movie where Doc has set up all the breakfast items.
On the alarm clock.
To show. And I was like, machine. That's really cool. That's fun.
That's really cute. Like I said, Doc's walking back into town now, smelling it. He has some conversation with someone here that's important.
Smelling it.
I think maybe this is when he runs back into Marty or whatever. I don't fucking matter. They're reunited. It's a blind spot, a rare one for me. They're reunited. They talk more. They got to get the plan together. They got today to get it ready for Monday morning when they're doing their thing. There's more exposition here. Stuff's happening. Things are in motion. The Undertaker measures Marty for his coffin.
Creepy Undertaker. Like,
yeah, exactly. Yeah,
he's just so bizarre. Like,
yeah, we run through it pretty quick. But I think basically we might as well jump to it. Like, they're out camping on the countryside, getting ready for in the morning to wake up to go get the train and take it over. Doc, however, is having a crisis of conscience here about what he should do about Clara. He wants to stay behind. Marty's like, you can't stay behind. There's a bunch of wishy-washy flip-flopping going on here in terms of what they're going to do and what they're not going to do. I forget if Marty says we could bring her with us, and I think he does, right? And Doc's like, no. And you're like, why? Wait, Doc, she's dead in our timeline. What's it matter? Yeah, we should steal her now. Who cares?
We should.
Doc doesn't see it that way, though. Doc flip-flops a bunch on what he wants to do. Eventually, though, I'm going to go, but I want to tell her the truth. So they go to bed, but then while Marty's sleeping, Doc gets up and leaves. He goes over to Clara. He tells her the whole shebang, right? I'm leaving, and here's the deal. Like, I'm a time traveler. She gets super pissed, as you'd expect. And it's just like, you should have just come right out and say, I don't love you anymore. I don't want to be with you. But that wouldn't be the truth. She slams the door. She goes and cries on her bed. Doc leaves, but he leaves a little smelly thing behind.
Right. But also noting, I think this was another nod to Jules Verne's like time machine, right? Which is like, why'd you steal the story from him? Why don't you just tell me the fucking truth?
Yeah, exactly.
And he's like, it's not a story. This is really
thing. I like this. Yeah.
Doc,
devastated, goes downtown to the bar where he asks for whiskey and leave the bottle. The bartender's trying to talk him out of it. You remember the 4th of July? Like, this is all funny. We don't know what that means, obviously. Doc goes to take a drink, but yeah, the Statler and Waldorf over there say something, get his attention, start talking about the future or whatever, and they say something about the future. We then jump from there over to Marty waking up. He realizes Doc's not there. He's like, oh shit, where the fuck's Doc? We gotta go get the stupid train. I overslept too. Mad Dog, he wakes up as well. He's like, come on guys, we gotta go kill this Eastwood guy. Marty puts it together pretty quick that he's probably down at the bar because that's just wherever he hangs out. He goes down there. Doc is still in there ranting about the future, right? He's talking about automobiles and how will we get it? Will people still walk or run? Yeah, so you run for fun. Run for fun! You know what I mean? Another great fucking...
This whole sequence is really confusing to me because when he initially takes the shot, I thought, oh, it's poison. Because passes out.
Drink, man.
He just has no tolerance for alcohol. Because he's never partied, never done anything.
Reaction to it.
I don't know. I just like, when it happened and he passes out, I was like, oh, was maybe like...
I'll be honest, if that was my reaction, I'd go immediately to the future doctor and be like, do I have a death allergy to alcohol? Yeah. So like, hold
real quick, I skipped it, I'm sorry. It wasn't Statler and Waldorf that got him at night. It was, in fact, just these traveling salesman dude who's like, it's a woman, isn't it? I've seen it a million times in every country I go.
Oh, right.
In the morning, it is Statler and Waldorf making fun of him. Like, how many of those has he had? And the bartender's like, that's his first one.
He's still holding it.
Yeah.
So fucking funny. It's just such a random thing. I really love that. But this is another example of like, why didn't they set up in the prior movies about him and alcohol? Not even a little bit.
Yeah, it's a silly goof, but I think, I think it works.
He doesn't drink, so it's like they couldn't have set it up, you know.
A lot of dialogue could have done it. They could have had any moment in a bar where he says, "Oh, not for me, Marty. I don't drink." You know, like
Marty's a kid. But it's, I understand exactly what you're saying. But it's like the same way where he's talking about like dedicating his life to science. He could have thrown it in there. I dedicate my life to science. I don't even drink. You know what I mean? But
yeah,
doesn't matter. Marty eventually wanders in the bar, finds Doc. Doc's all hard, and Marty's like, "Fucking snap out of it, you idiot! We have to go back to the. You have to save my life. I'm a child." And he's like, "Oh fuck, right. Oh, let's go." And so he's like, all right, goodbye, everybody, blah, blah, blah. And then like a moron takes the shot and then he just bites it immediately in a very funny way, I think, bites it through the table, goes down. Marty's like, how many is he getting? That's his first one. Even Marty's like, what a fucking pussy. So he's trying to wake him, slap him in the face. It's not happening. And then the bartender gets this whole like thing of like, I got just the thing. Jimmy, wake up juice. And it's just a fucking Bloody Mary, it looks like. But it's whatever.
It's all weird. This whole thing is bizarre as
well. It gets very like slapstick comedian or whatever, right? So he puts a funnel in Doc's mouth, pours this Bloody Mary in. Doc sits up and he runs out to the trough, shoves his head in. And then he comes back up and passes back out. And he's like, oh, he's not really up yet. That's just the reaction. All right, they drag him back in. While he's back in there, Tannen shows back up and he's like, Eastwood, I'm going to kill you. He's like, fuck, goddamn, you're early. And they have this whole conversation about time again where you're like, I don't like you, but I respect you, Tannen. And this goes on. Eventually, Doc does wake up. He's got a headache and it's like, all right, cool. What are we going to fucking do? Seamus is there too. And he's like, Marty's like, he's calling me chicken. What do I do? And he's like, you got to go out there and fight him, son. Otherwise, you'll be Clint Eastwood, the yellow belly coward of the West. And he's like, who fucking cares? Why does this matter? It just doesn't matter. I don't have to do this. He's an asshole. Marty has this moment, right, Nick? You always talk about it.
I love that. He's an asshole. I don't have to. Like, he literally says that. Like, I don't have to play this guy's game. Like, what do I care what this asshole thinks about?
Right.
So you fucking yokels that are all going to probably die of dysentery or fucking your sisters.
Yeah, chlamydia. You know what I mean? Oh, we're in Kansas? I didn't realize that. I thought we were still in California.
We don't know where Mills Valley is.
So then it was like, do you have a back door? And the bartender's like, yeah, in the back. So they go out the back door. And immediately one of Tannen's dudes sees him and starts shooting at him, right? Marty runs into a side door. Doc falls down behind a barrel. They grab Doc, drag him out, and he's basically like, you got 1 minute to come out here, Eastwood, or I'm gonna kill this guy. I'm gonna kill this blacksmith. Marty had already dove on the ground to avoid bullets. He had knocked the door off of the oven. So he gets a plan, a callback to Back to the Future 2, of course, when Biff was watching the Clint Eastwood movie where Clint also had a piece of metal bulletproof vest on.
That's awesome.
He finally goes out there. He's like, hey, all right, let Doc go. They let Doc go. They push him off to the side. He's like, all right, time to fight. He's like, no, it's not. I won't fight you. He drops his belt. He's like, I thought we could settle this like men. And Mad Dog's like, you thought wrong. And just fucking blows him one in the chest. Pow, right there. Drops him. And then he does this hilarious.
I love it. I love the way he walks.
He's like so fucking good. So fucking good as he walks down.
At this point, I'm like, I had switched to headphones because some kids outside are like yelling and they were being annoying. And it was so funny hearing the ADR like, I thank you.
it's so uncharacter for one of the Tanners to just be like, I tricked him.
So he walks down there. He gets over Marty and turns out Marty's not dead. And Marty kicks the gun out of his hand, then grabs the thing and hits him in the face with it, showing it was bulletproof, punches him. He punches him around the town for a little bit before, I guess, then hitting him with the thing, knocking him down. He goes through the tombstone that was going to be Doc's tombstone. We left out the whole thing of looking at the photograph, and the photograph keeps changing. It erases Doc's name, then it puts in Eastwood's name, and like we talked about it earlier, of course, that was why he couldn't go out there and actually shoot him. He had to come up with something better.
I love that it was ambiguous for a little while. It was just blank and it was like, who knows who's gonna be on here?
Man, it's Kevin, just like broke up all of that, none of that made sense. But it was funny and we like you. So then that's done. Biff's down. Mad Dog, Buford Mad Dog, Tana's down.
It goes into manure, right?
The final punch puts him in the manure, face down in the manure. The U.S. Marshals show up. They're like, everybody else, I think Buford's going to jail. Yeah, and the bad guys run. Marshals ride up. They're like, oh, get him out of that and take him in. Go catch them. They pull him out. They're like, Buford Tannen, you're under arrest for robbing whatever stagecoach or whatever the fuck it was from Sunday. Do you have anything to say? And he spits out a bunch of manure and he goes, I hate manure. No, that was the end of that.
Gross.
Marty then hands his gun belt to Seamus and is like, here you go. It's worth at least $12. He's like, maybe I'll trade it for a new hat, don't you know? And they're like, all
right,
cool. Like,
motherfucker, that's like 20 new hats right there.
Exactly.
You like, Irish don't know how money works in America. That's how it goes.
Okay, cool. We don't know. We got a train to catch. So Marty and Doc run off there. I left off that at the same time all this other plan of action was happening, Clara had gotten on her train to leave town. She was like so heartbroken over Doc being a bitch that she was like, I'm just gonna fucking go and never come back. And so she's on the train, and as fate and destiny would have it, the traveling salesman from before is sitting in front of her, and he's doing the whole thing. I'm like, I've said it before, and I've never seen a man so heartbroken before. What did they call her name? Sarah Rara Block, right? And the guy next was like, Clara. And she's like, whoa, did he have puppy dog eyes? Did he have this fucking hideous white hair? you're either describing a fucking Dementor or Doc Brown. So she jumps up, hits the thing, the train stops, which helps Marty and Doc, I'm sure, in their timeline. She gets out and she just takes off running. She gets a she ran to the blacksmith shop. She found the time machine, the diorama or whatever, and she put it together.
And she knows it's a time machine because they were, for some reason, the two of them decided we didn't know which just what the shape was. Let's write time machine on it. Just so
we don't forget. Yeah.
So we don't forget that the thing looks exactly like a DeLorean. The
car we have right there.
Yeah.
So she's like, fuck. So she takes off riding. Meanwhile, Marty and Doc are over there and they put on their bandanas. They get on the back of this train. They climb across the top of the train. They get down there and they're like, they jump in and they say, what's going on? And he's like, are we being robbed or something? He's like, it's a science experiment. Train stops. They get rid of all the carts and all the people and all the stuff except for all the wood, which I really don't think they need. But maybe they can't get rid of that. I'm not a train expert. And they got the train engine. They ride that motherfucker over and they switch the track and they get it there and they set it up to the DeLorean. And like, all right, time to fucking go. We got to do this thing. They start the train up. Claire's riding up behind them. Marty's in the DeLorean. Doc's in the actual train. He's got the logs he's got to toss in there. I thought in my head, I remember him tossing them in one at a time. He just tosses them all in at once.
No, throws them all in. Me too.
They're set to fucking blow out. He understands fire better than me. And I believe it. He tosses them in. Clara gets there. She gets her hand on the back of the train car, the wood pile. She grabs it, that thing. Just as she grabs it and starts to pull herself up, the first one blows, giving them a huge jolt. She kicks up like she's fucking getting dragged by Superman through the air. It's pretty cool. And then this scene goes on too long, right, Tim? But she's working her way forward. She's young.
There is a part of me, Grant, like I do kind of feel like Marty in this spot where I was like, fuck, why is she here? She's ruining this. Like, you're going to like complicate the situation.
Right.
Doc, there's other fish in the sea. get to the future, refill the time machine and come back and get her. That's all you got to do.
Thing blows. She gets knocked back a little bit again. She's like, whoa. Doc climbs out. He fucking just turtle crawls across this fucking steam engine to get up closer and he's like, I'm coming. They got the walkie talkies they're working with. She finally gets to the cabin of the steam engine. Doc's barely made it a fucking foot because he sucks.
Where's his walkie talkie?
Don't ask questions
because like Marty keeps talking to the walkie talkie and Doc's like holding on to the train.
Oh yeah,
it's probably on his chest.
There's something. A very interesting cut where he's like clearly like and the next one he's like, yeah, I got it, Marty, don't worry. Doesn't matter. So as Doc's about to make his move to the DeLorean, the train whistle blows. He's like, wait, what the fuck? Looks back, sees Clara, tells Marty it's Clara. All right, it's Clara. Doc goes back to get her. She starts coming. She falls. She gets caught. Her dress gets caught, and that's what's keeping her alive, basically. The panic ensues of how we're going to get her. That's what happened is the third log blew, getting them up to their ramming speed here of 88.
The red one.
Her hair gets past the point of no return. The
wheels spins in, pulls her head in, fucking.
The boiler explodes. They have shrapnel inside of them, probably through the fucking DeLorean, too. It's point of no return. We're past it. Something's got to give. Marty figures out the hoverboard, raises Doc hoverboard, lets the hoverboard go. Doc, with his cat-like reflexes, is able to put his foot right into it. Perfect. Great movie. Whatever. Right about the same time, he turns. Clara falls. He grabs her. He whisks her up, and it's this really weird thing of them going to happiness, but in really awkwardly done. It's whatever.
Real, real badly.
It looks bad, yeah.
Marty notices what time it is. He slams the door shut. He's got all his time circuits and everything activated to go back to 1985. They're going towards the dead end thing that'll be completed in the next year. They, boom, it's, the fire trail through for the DeLorean. Then, as Doc said, the DeLorean's safe, but it's a spectacular explosion for the steam engine that careens off down into what used to be Clayton Ravine, which was whatever I can ever remember when it was for
Eastwood
them.
Ravine
now. And now becomes Eastwood Ravine.
Oh, right.
Signifying that Clint Eastwood died there, of course. So they knew that he, yes, did this. They did not know, I guess, that Emmett did, or maybe they didn't. They didn't care. Jump back to 1985. They
were like, we're going to put you in jail. And he goes, I give you the iceberg.
Totally. Exactly. Like, wow. Clap, 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 clap.
You could have just stopped at ice.
I said, yeah, I know. I could have just said ice. I want to say ice cube. But I said Berg instead, which is a much bigger volume of ice.
It's so much bigger, Nick. It's really big.
The car rolls through across a bridge here in California, across a Eastwood Ravine, rolls on through into subdivision Hilldale, which is where Marty and Jennifer will live later on.
What a fucking joy this movie is.
Right.
I just love seeing the 80s, like the cars and actually the 80s, because now the only time you see that is when people like make a period piece. But actually, when you see like those old like Oldsmobiles and stuff like that, doesn't that give you a tinge of nostalgia?
Sure. Totally. For a worse time. Anyways, they roll through. They're all staring at him, but Marty's able to get just far enough away. And he's like, oh, man, we did it. And he gets up. But then before he even has a chance to take a breath, right, a train comes barreling down at him. As you'd expect, Marty's able to jump out the last second. The DeLorean is pulverized, which, of course, is what Doc wanted to happen anyway. By the way, we left that out.
It's fantastic.
Doc wanted it destroyed when he got back anyway. So Marty gets up. He's like, I guess what you got, what you wanted, Doc. And there's like fucking smoldering pieces and the license plate and the flux capacitor and everything's just fucked to hell. And even his photo is ruined. He's like, I'm fucking mad. And so what he does from there is goes back to
Jennifer's house. Home. I just want to add, to have a car crushed by a train. Train will easily be derailed.
But again, it's the DeLorean, right? It just falls apart. Just falls apart.
That's true. He just rips through it. Right. The old 1955 like vehicle could have ripped through it as well.
There's some part of me that's also like, you got to go at least get some of the future tech off that rail.
Totally.
Because if someone finds this flux capacitor, whether they're like, what the
cool license plate from the future, do something to hide your tracks here. Instead, he goes home. The family comes back out. It's the brother, the sister, Lorraine, and then in the way back, George McFly. Biff's there as well. He was getting the second paint coat of wax in the fucking truck. Thought you guys were already at the lake. What's going on? There's confusion about brunch. But no, he's here. He's dressed like a cowboy. Everybody's like, fine about it, whatever. Marty takes the truck, runs over to Jennifer's. Wakes her up on her porch, as we were talking about. She had been left, obviously, during Back to the Future 2 in the bad dimension, but now everything's back to normal. He wakes her up dressed like a cowboy.
Yeah. And she's like, I had the craziest dream. And he's like, you were definitely dreaming. And she's like, you're totally dressed like a fucking cowboy.
I'm dressed like a cowboy.
I was not dreaming.
Yeah, it probably has some disease on these clothes that nobody knows about anymore.
But she also had that piece of paper, right? Is how she knows.
We don't know that yet. He's able to be like, oh, yeah, that's a weird fucking dream. All right, let's go in my car. So they get in the car and they start the truck and they drive away. And then they pass the front entrance to Hilldale where they will.
Oh, right.
He's like, this is where we're going to live one day. I mean, where we should. And she's like, what the fuck? That was an unforced error, cowboy man. Why would you blurt that out right now? And he's like, and she's like, it was a dream, right, Marty? And he's and at the same time, Needle shows up. And this is what you're talking about earlier with all the, the Avengers of Biff.
Goons through time.
Also playing the Huey Lewis song. And I appreciate that.
Yeah.
He's like, hey, McFly, I'm Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers.
So fucking awesome.
Fucking race. Kills he's like, all right, fuck. And he's like, no, I don't want any. He's like, what are you, chicken? He's like, I'll fucking show you. He's like, goddamn chicken. Pulls out the gun. Bam. Probably. Yeah. Cowboy. Now, instead, he's like, yeah.
That bullet. It's from 100 years ago.
He revs the engine. And everybody's like, oh, man, it's going to fucking happen. And so then Needles takes off. And instead of just not going anywhere, Marty puts it in reverse and goes backwards. Could have easily run over somebody or slammed into somebody, but he doesn't. Then he pulls a really dramatic fucking 180, so like Elizabeth's shoes like fucking thrown around the cab all crazy.
He doesn't want to be the only person with the brain damage as we go forward. He wants her fucking ping-ponging off all the windows.
I mean, something's clearly wrong with her anyways, man. This woman, anytime something crazy happens, she's just like, oh, neato. It's like, out of all people in this franchise, she has the most insane experiences.
She
within like 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And she also just reading those stats, she's younger than she's supposed to be.
I love Elizabeth Shue, and I think she's a great actor. And I just think she did not do a very good job in this. And I blame
they didn't give her much to work with.
They didn't give her anything to work with, and I'm pretty sure she probably only shot on both movies for a total of like 5 days.
Totally.
Because she's not in much of this. Yeah. So you have to imagine she's like, contextually, I have no fucking idea what's going on.
But also, I think if she is supposed to react and have this sort of like this gigantic sort of, what are you talking about? What's up? Like, I think that takes away the focus of the movie at that point. Like,
then just don't have her then. It's distracting to have her in and just be like, oh, that's 10 time machines. I was in the fucking future and you're a cowboy now.
Yeah.
Anyways, he spins at 180. They look out, or maybe I think he just might have done a whatever. Doesn't matter.
He did a 180.
They look out the back window. Needles is still just driving like a moron, and a Rolls Royce pulls out that Needles narrowly misses. But if Marty and Jennifer had accelerated, they in fact would have slammed into it, and it would have been the accident with the Rolls Royce from Back to the Future 2 that Marty's mom was so happy to tell. What's her name? Mary Lou McFly
or whatever. Marlene.
Marlene McFly all about. And that's the realization of like, that would have done it. And that's when Jennifer reaches in, pulls out the facts from the future that says you're fired. and then it slowly fades away. At this point, Marty's like, fuck, you know what? I'm done lying to you, woman I supposedly love and trust. Let's go to where the fucking DeLorean's destroyed. And so he walk up there, it really is destroyed. It's all fucked up. This sucks, man. Yeah, and I'll never see Doc again. And then the ding, 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 things come down for a train coming. And they all look around. There's no fucking train. What's going on? Fucking there it is. It's a time train. It's fucking, and it's, it rolls on in. It's big and it's black and it's purple. You know what I mean? This thing's there to fucking.
Veiny.
And the fucking side opens up and it's Doc like, you know what I mean? It's me. And so Claire is there and she's like, oh, what's up? And I want to introduce you to my kids. It's Jules and Vern. They have the two kids there.
I'll tell you what, Vern looks like a psychopath. I never noticed what's that his kid. Deal?
He's the one who did the finger thing, right?
Yeah, he's the one who points his penis in this episode.
Why does he do that?
Which it's been theorized that he's actually trying to tell people that he has to pee. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you're not aware of what
we're talking about. We're not there in the storyline, but when they do a punch in and Doc does the whole like, future's whatever you want it to be, make it a good one. You can see the youngest boy there, Vern, do a motion with his hand for, and the camera starts coming in and he points at his penis really creepily. But it is that, yeah, we think it was just a kid who had to pee. Anyways, though.
Mima.
Mima, help me. Beep, beep. They're talking about it. Clara gives Marty or Doc a package to give to Marty. He opens up. It is your friend in time, Doc Brown. And it's the photo of them in front of the clock. The time machine runs on steam now. They're just ping ponging around the timelines. Jennifer's like, this got erased. She says Dr. Brown, I believe. Like, Elizabeth Shue's never even seen the first fucking movie. Dr. Emmett Brown. This got erased. Why? And he's like, oh, of course it did. They, you know, nobody's future set in stone. So make it a good one. I fucked that up, but it's a good line. I really do appreciate it. And I think it is a very touching ending to it. And that's the thing. And then so like now it's all right, cool. You're gonna stick around, you're gonna go to the future. He's like, no, I've already been there. It's like, wait a second, where the fuck are you going, Doc? Yeah. Already been there. So we're going back to the past. Like, where the fuck do you guys live? What about the space time continuum?
You're not thinking fifth dimensionally.
Greg. I'm not thinking fourth dimensionally.
They're traveling back and forth through all of time.
That's great. That won't end badly for everybody.
What a cool vacation!
This fucking thing.
They have this awesome, I'm assuming, indestructible flying train. Like they're fine. Mm-hmm. They're gonna, you know, launch in space and be fine.
Rest of us, we're gonna have a fucking lizard people being the president. You know what I mean? That's what we're gonna end up with, thanks to their fucking fuckery. Anyways, they go up, the thing turns around, spins, shoots off. Boof,
so fucking good. The end really pops in. It's just like, dude, what a trilogy. How did they just did it? They're like, you know what? We're making some dope ass freaking movies. What an accomplishment.
What an accomplishment.
All right, let's do haiku and review.
Seven syllables in the middle. You need five for the first and last line. If you're not poetic, no need to fret it. Haiku need rhyme.
Haiku in review.
Haiku in review. It's so awesome.
You can go to patreon.com/kindoffunny for your haiku reviews, just like Jacob Solo did. In the wild, wild west, Marty gets hung by Mad Dog and Doc makes some ice. That's a good summary. Daniel Edmund says, Doc, stuck in the past. Wild West, such a contrast. Franchise, unsurpassed.
Whoa. That's good. That's real good.
Nailed it. Alex says, part three's the best, Clint. Eastwood's the biggest yellow. Belly in the West. You're playing fast and loose with this haiku rules.
Yeah, they're doing like the hip-hop thing where you start one line in the first verse and you continue. You know what I mean?
You're fired. Everyone's fired.
Ignacio Ross says, best trilogy ever. Hill Valley's Gene Pool makes no sense. What's up with Doc's kid?
Yeah, he's freaky.
Ignacio Ross also says, it's come full circle. Marty married to his mom. This series is weird.
It's very strange.
Blackjack says, Doc's heart, not so cold. Clara, a sight to behold. The future is untold.
Oh, that's great. Wow. Blackjack is a poet, dude.
Yeah, man. Didn't even know it. John Lestrina says, the worst of the three is still a 5-star rating. We drink whiskey here. And boom. There it is. Ragu bagu, baby.
Ragu. Bagu.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to Rad Guys Talk Bad Guys, the podcast within a podcast. I'm one of your hosts, Greg, alongside Andy, Kevin, Tim, and Nick. Of course, this is where we rank all the villains of the Back to the Future cinematic universe and rank them for your approval. If you like that, you can go over to @RagubaguVids on Twitter. Sometimes Andy tweets about it. You know what I mean? Currently, in Volume 8 of Ragu Bagu, the list stands at this. Number 1, Biff Griff, Old Biff, and Trump Biff from Back to the Future 2. Number 2, Biff and Billy from Back to the Future. Guys, where do we want to put Buford, Mad Dog, Tannen?
Number 2.
Yeah, I'm number two.
I think number one with a bullet. I enjoy every moment of him. You know what I mean?
But he's
not as bad
or as like.
But he's enjoyable, and it's a movie. No, that's like, true. Are we ranking guys in terms of their badness, or are we ranking the bad guys in terms of their funness?
These are all gradable things.
Yeah.
I would say number two. I would say number two just because the original Biff Tannen is like iconic.
That's not even number one.
That's fine, but that right now Biff Tannen.
Oh, Biff from. Oh, then I'm sorry. I apologize. I'll put Mad Dog at number one then.
Thank you. I just think he's the funnest. He's the most interesting. I didn't like. I know that Griff is interesting and a great performance. I just don't like Griff. I'm just gonna say it.
I'll put him at number one.
But remember, that also included Biff from the future, where he is Donald Trump.
Yeah.
Because you know why I put him at number one? I just appreciate that the actor. We always forget his name.
Thomas F. Wilson.
Thomas F. Wilson. Does a great job of just becoming a Western villain. And it's so seamless. I think it's a great performance.
That's true. But
Nick, your beard is getting insane.
He did a great job of being like four people.
That's true.
Biff, old Biff, and Trump Biff.
But I didn't love futuristic Biff.
Yeah.
Too close to what's happening now.
Griff or whatever.
Politics.
Well, that was awesome. All right. So then I'm voting number one. Andy's voting number one. Nick's voting number one.
Sure.
There you go. The final rankings for Back to the Future Cinematic Universe are number one, Mad Dog from Back to the Future 3, Biff, Griff, Old Biff, and Trump Biff from Back to the Future 2, and Biff and Billy from Back to the Future.
Good old Biff and Billy. Now it's time to rank the Back to the Future Cinematic Universe. Currently, number one, we have Back to the Future 1, and number two, we have Back to the Future 2. I definitely think this is number three.
Someone's at your front door.
Yeah, I got some Signore's pizza coming, guys. I feel like this movie is great. It's like it's super enjoyable. It's way, way better than I remember giving it credit for. Like I feel like growing up, I'd always give it a 7, which is still good. But I feel like now I'm like, oh, I'd give it at least an 8. But I just think that it's safe. It plays it too safe. It nails the landing, but it's there's nothing about this that is like ridiculously cool or interesting. And I feel like a lot of it is derivative and it's satisfying. This is a very satisfying movie. A lot of payoffs, and all those payoffs make you feel good. And you're like, oh man, you feel nostalgic, which is great. Like they just totally nailed the vibe of it all. But it's like, I just feel like it's missing the Back to the Future elements of the shenanigans and the craziness of the time travel. And I think the two does that so well towards the end of the movie, like 2/3 of the movie. And the first third is necessary to set that stuff up. And it going back to one, I just feel like the way it all ties together, I feel like two is superior to three. All three together, though, this might be the best trilogy of all time.
I mean, I shock myself, like I said earlier, but like I put it at number two, Back to the Future 3 at number two. And I think it is just that fact that I think Back to the Future 2, while great, and like imagine the future stuff just doesn't work, and what we're talking about last time around, right, where it's cool and it's definitely in there for kids, and I loved it then and I love it now in terms of what it is and like this fun, you know, satirical look at what the 2015 would look like from the 80s or whatever. But I think that it takes too long to get cooking to being a Back to the Future movie, Back to the Future 2, whereas this one from the start is. Now granted, it's different. It's again literally the argument about Uncharted when you talk about it, of like this pivoting to Doc and making it about him and his love interest and all these different things is a change, but I appreciated it watching them all back to back to back here and getting into it. I liked that change. I thought that it did have cool moments. I thought there was tension there. I think, you know, the final scene with the locomotives, or not the final scene, but the final action scene with the locomotive drags on a bit. But I enjoyed, like we were talking about earlier, Nick, of, you know, the new look of the DeLorean and how, you know, it was to send it back in time to 1885. I like the Mad Dog. I like Mad Dog, I think, the most, obviously, as we just voted for the bad guys. I think, it does. It's Back to the Future 2, I think, is too complicated. There's too much going on, whereas I think this one is simplified and does play it safe, but I like that, and I think it's an appropriate way to end the trilogy.
For me, I was going to say, like, piggybacking off what you're saying at the end here, it's like, to me, I love all these movies, and 3 just is a little bit too childish, where it all seems very gimmicky and kind of I love in 2 that it creates these complex things that you kind of think about, and you know that bleeds over into 3 a little bit, not as much, but like I think that all happens because 2 sets all these rules that you're kind of like now playing with. Still surprisingly good movies.
Yeah, I mean, we're splitting hairs here a little bit too, because they're all great movies. And again, this is one of the best trilogy of movies ever made. I was actually surprised. I'm with Greg on this one, where I watched 3 and I was like, I really, really think this is a well-made movie. It never drags, save for maybe a couple seconds at the end there. But I remember watching it when I was younger, thinking like, well, this is a lot of tension. I don't know how they're going to get out of this situation, until Marty remembers he's got the hoverboard. I think when I think back to the future, I think the movie has to be one thing, and that's entertaining. And 3 is 100% entertaining all the way through. 2 just drags for the first 45 minutes. And while I do give out extra points to what Kevin's saying, which is introducing the concept of like the parallel timelines and paradoxes and all the stuff, and really kind of getting a little bit more deep in the sci-fi, I think 3 brings it back to where it should be, which is what we love so much in the first one, which is that it is just lean. Everything in there is in there for a reason. It's a good contained story with a sharp structure. And by the end, we feel very, very, very satisfied. And it's so difficult to do, especially for a third act, right? You think of another third act like Return of the Jedi, where it just kind of feels like a lesser version of the original Star Wars. And in this one, it's like they've set up so much in the second one that it feels like you're paying off a lot of it in the third one. But unfortunately, that doesn't make the second one more entertaining. It just makes it more important. So I guess I don't above it.
It's interesting you say that, because I feel like 2 and 3 are a huge step down from 1. Like, especially watching them now all together, like 1 is a perfect movie. 2 and 3 are just really damn good movies, and it makes a really damn good trilogy. But I think that there is a gap that is gigantic between the quality specifically of 1 and 3. If you're just looking at it as standalone simple stories that make sense, 1 is so much more compelling and so much more interesting, and it's exciting and there's like cool stuff, whereas I feel like with this one it's like it just got the job done.
Yeah. I kind of agree with Greg and Tim Greg and Nick, where I think going into this movie I had always been sort of led to believe that part 3 wasn't very good, and they got worse and worse as they went on. I remember Jared Petty saying that he liked 3 more than 2, and Greg would shit on him and make fun of him for that.
I was like, shit on Jared Petty.
Yeah, of course. But yeah, watching this, I do think it's a cleaner, better told story than part 2. I think it's overall a little bit less confusing, and you're always kind of made aware and made clear about what's happening in the timeline and what the actual motivation and what they're trying to get to and how they're trying to solve these problems. I love everything Western about it in terms of the more gimmicky parts. You know, here's what happened in part 1, but here's the Western version of that. I appreciated that more, as opposed to here's the sci-fi version of what we did in part 1. And again, yeah, totally agree with Nick, where part 2 just feels like it dragged for the first 40-45 minutes. And during that part, I never thought, I kind of thought this movie isn't very good, until it turned around and we get back to the sort of disgusting, slummy parts of the 80s where the whole timeline had screwed up. I think this movie is just more enjoyable, and I think it's a little bit better told.
All right, time to vote. Who thinks that Back to the Future 3 is better than 2? Raise your hand. Everyone except for me and Kev raise our hand. That means that the new rankings are number 1, Back to the Future 1, number 2, Back to the Future 3, and number 3, Back to the Future 2.
I respect that you didn't even waste people's time with putting up against Back to the Future 1.
Oh, sorry. Yeah.
We all know that.
Does anybody vote that it's
over? No, fuck no.
A perfect movie, guys. A perfect movie.
So here's the deal, guys. I'm going to announce all the new in review plans for the next
one. Ooh.
All of this. What's up?
What? I just said, yeah, boy.
Oh, I heard. I said, wait.
Yeah.
So anyways, this is all tentative. Any things can change. Schedules can, whatever the hell, you know, life's weird right now. But the plan, and I'm feeling pretty good about it based on the people I've talked to. We are going to continue Transformers in Review on Fridays.
Thank God.
Thank God. Starting next week on Tuesdays, we are going to be doing Kevin Smith's View Askew Universe in review. Greg Miller wanted to do it. And when Greg Miller wants something, baby, we got to make it happen.
I get it. Unless it's Ghostbusters or
Pac-Man. So we're going to be doing that, and that's super fun. But there's something more exciting about that because it works out perfectly, and God, I love when this shit works out perfectly. Transformers is going to end while the Kevin Smith movies are still going. So by the time we're getting around Clerks 2, it has to face up against something else, another franchise.
What could it possibly be?
The best trilogy of
all time. What is the big debate right now?
I mean, the real big debate everyone's talking about.
Andy, there's six of those movies, just so you know. It's not a trilogy.
Is Clerks better than Lord of the Rings, Tim?
That's what the world needs to know. So eventually when Transformers ends, we will be switching over to Lord of the Rings. We're finally doing it. Elise Willems will be joining us for Lord of the Rings in review. And Andrew Renee will be sending in segments similar to like what McCook has done for Bad Boys and stuff like that. So, man, we're getting the whole gang together. This is going to be a lot of fun. We're doing it. We're going all out, boys.
Can't wait. I'm very excited for this.
Until then.
Great. Ah, shit. Great, God, Scott.
Will you fucking figure this out, Andy?
Great, Scott.
I got nothing for this, man.
That's heavy, Doc.